Tanto Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Underworld, The Mysterious Origins of Civilization by Graham Hancock. Narrated by Dennis Kleinman. Part 1. Initiation. 1. Relics. If you do not expect it, you will not find the unexpected, for it is hard to find and difficult. Heraclitus. 5 kilometers off the southeast coast of India, submerged at a depth of 23 meters beneath the murky, shark-infested waters of the Bay of Bengal, an ancient man-made structure sits on the bottom of the sea. The structure is U-shaped, like a huge horseshoe. Its periphery measures 85 meters, and its walls are about 1 meter thick and 2 meters high. The discovery was made by a team of marine archaeologists from India's National Institute of Oceanography, NIO, in March 1991, working offshore of the Tranquebar-Pumpuhar coast of Tamil Nadu, near Nagapattinam. Their equipment included side-scan sonar, which transmits an acoustic signal up to 1,000 meters wide and measures the strength of the returning echo. Towed behind a research vessel, side-scan sonar is capable of building accurate maps of seabed contours and of identifying any obvious anomalies such as shipwrecks. On 7 March 1991, a shipwreck at a depth of 19 meters was pinpointed by the sonar. It was investigated by divers on 8 and 9 March, who found many scattered objects, including lead ingots and iron cannon, on the surrounding seabed. The official report of the project then states, "Till 1 p.m. on 9 March, the divers were working on the scattered objects. T.C.S. Rao, who was carrying out sonar survey 5 kilometers opposite Chinnavanagiri, not far from the wreck, reported another object 40 by 10 meters having the shape of a ship recorded on sonograph. Sri Bandotkar was sent to the site designated PMR2, and he placed 2 marker buoys there. By 2 p.m., Manavi and Chini dived, but as the buoys had drifted, the object could not be explored. A second side-scan sonar survey later in the afternoon refined the measurements, suggesting that the object was oval and measured 30 to 35 meters east to west and 10 meters north to south, with an apparent opening on one side. On 16 and 19 March, T.C.S. Rao continued the survey and now reported, "There are actually 3 objects, the central one being oval-shaped with an opening on the northern side. Its longer axis is 20 meters. There is a clay deposit on the eastern flank, beyond which another semicircular structure is seen. To the northwest of the central object, 1 or more oval-shaped objects are found." Finally, on 23 March 1991, 3 divers were able to go down, but only had sufficient air to study the central structure. The official report describes what they saw as follows: a horseshoe-shaped object, its height being 1 or 2 meters. A few stone blocks were found in the 1 meter wide arm. The distance between the 2 arms is 20 meters. Whether the object is a shrine or some other man-made structure, now at 23 meters depth, remains to be examined in the next field season. Deep can mean very old. In the event no work could be done at the site in the next season, but in 1993, the structure was examined again by the NIO's diver archaeologists, who took careful measurements and eventually reported their findings as follows. The structure of U-shape was located at a water depth of 23 meters, which is about 5 kilometers offshore. The total peripheral length of the object is 85 meters, while the distance between the 2 arms is 13 meters and the maximum height is 2 meters. The height of the eastern arm is greater than that of the western arm. The center of the object is covered with sediment, but some patches of rock were noticed. Hand fanning showed that the central part of the object is rocky at a depth of 10 to 15 centimeters. Divers observed growth of thick marine organism on the structure, but in some sections a few courses of masonry were noted. Since 1993, for want of funding, no further marine archaeology has been conducted along the Pumpuhar coast, and the general impression has been disseminated in archaeological literature that the NIO has not found any submerged structures there that are older than the 3rd century BC. This is certainly true of numerous structures that were excavated very near to the shore, usually in depths of less than 2 meters of water and often half exposed at low tide. But the U-shaped structure at 23 meters, more than 70 feet, is another matter altogether and cannot by any means be automatically assigned to the 3rd century BC. On the contrary, since we know that the sea level has been continuously rising during the last 19,000 years, common sense suggests that structures now submerged by 23 meters of water must be much older than structures in just 2 meters. Nobody has looked. In February 2000, I travelled to Bangalore to the home of the doyen of India's marine archaeologists, S. R. Rao, founder of the Marine Archaeology Centre at the NIO and the man who had led the Tranquebar Pumpahar survey. Rao is a distinguished, lean-faced man in his mid-70s with boundless energy and enthusiasm for his subject. After the pleasantries were over, I told him that I was intrigued by the U-shaped structure his team had found at Pumpahar. 23 meters is deep. Doesn't that mean that it could be very old? Correct, definitely, Rao replied. That is what we are also thinking. In fact, we took our ocean engineer also to see whether the structure had gone down as a result of erosion by the sea or by its own weight. I don't think that is the case, because it is a huge structure which has been built at that depth. At that time, the sea was further out. This was built when it was above water. Then does the sea rise so much within such a short period was the question, 23 meters just within 2,000 years or so. Maybe the sea level rise that covered this structure took place a lot earlier than that, I offered. Maybe it belongs to a much earlier period than the 2,000-year-old ruins of Pumpahar in the intertidal zone. There have been sea level rises that could have done something like this, but they took place a long time ago, at the end of the Ice Age. Correct. At that time it happened. You are correct. There were three large floods at the end of the Ice Age, and even the most recent of these takes us back 8,000 years. Is that a possible date for the U-shaped structure? We don't know, Rao replied, because you see, from whatever we have got, we are not able to decide its date at all. Why is that? Because amongst the samples we took, we found no organic materials that could be dated by carbon-14 and no pottery that could be dated by thermoluminescence or by type. We have only stone which cannot be dated in any meaningful sense. Except by one factor, which is that the structure is now under 23 meters of water. So the sea level rise itself can be helpful in indicating a date. Correct. I do know that for the Gulf of Kutch in northwestern India, an oceanographic study has been made, and the oceanographers themselves have said that at 10,000 BC, the sea level was 60 meters lower than it is today. If that is true there, it is also true here. Which raises the possibility that we may be looking at remnants of a previously unknown ancient culture. Ancient, definitely, Rao exclaimed. And, in fact, where really was the origin of India's earliest known civilization, the Indus Valley Civilization? Scholars guess, but nobody knows. The Indus Valley script itself is already a highly developed script when it first appears in the 3rd millennium BC. The early architecture is already developed. You have got brick structures, you have got drains, everything is planned and all that. So there must be something before that. Where is the evolutionary phase? We don't know. Dr. Rao was getting close to the real reason that I'd come to see him. Maybe the evidence of the evolutionary phase is underwater, I suggested. It's underwater? Quite possible. If so, then this underwater structure at Pumpahar could be incredibly important, simply because of its depth. 23 meters. 23 meters. That's right. Now, if we can rule out land subsidence, and further work must be done before we can rule that out, but if we can rule that out, and if it's an issue exclusively of sea level rise, then we have a discovery here that calls into question the accepted chronology of civilization. Rao pondered for a moment before replying. You see, some people, some traditions, do say that there was a continent in the Indian Ocean a very long time ago, more than 10,000 years ago, that got submerged. Quite possible. You see, we are not doing thorough research. If we had taken more time and more funds and all that, perhaps we could find many more structures, not only that one, and then you could come to some kind of conclusion about the much earlier epoch. I told Rao that I was familiar with the South Indian traditions to which he was referring. These describe extensive lands, submerged about 11,000 years ago, that had once existed in the Indian Ocean to the south of the present Cape Comorin. The name of these lost lands was Kumari Kandam. At the time of their inundation, the traditions say, they had been the home of a high civilization that had even boasted an academy of advanced learning, where philosophy and literature were cultivated. It must have existed, Rao asserted. You can't rule that out at all, particularly, as I've said, since we have found the structure at 23-meter depth. I mean, we have photographed it. It is there. Anybody can go and see. I do not believe that it is an isolated structure. Further exploration is likely to reveal others roundabout, and then you can go deeper, you see, and you may get more important things. I asked if there had been any further attempts since 1993 to find underwater structures off southern India. No, Rao replied. Nobody has looked. Ken Shindo's story. In 1996, 4 years before my meeting with Rao, my book Fingerprints of the Gods became the number one bestseller in Japan, a country that had fascinated me since childhood. The book's success gave me my first opportunity to travel there. I visited Japan twice that year to give a series of public lectures about the issues I'd explored in Fingerprints of the Gods. On the second visit, I was approached after a lecture by a photojournalist named Ken Shindo, who works for the influential Kyodo Sushing News Agency. He showed me striking underwater pictures that he had taken of a bizarre terraced structure, apparently a man-made monument of some kind, lying at depths of up to 30 meters off the south coast of the Japanese island of Yonaguni. My central research and writing interest for years has been the possibility of a lost civilization destroyed in the cataclysmic global floods that brought the last ice age to an end. So I was immediately fascinated by Shindo's story. An underwater ruin here in Japan, I exclaimed. Is it definitely man-made? Shindo laughed. Some people say it's a freak of nature, but they haven't spent time on it like I have. I'm absolutely certain it's man-made. Does anyone know how old it is? Shindo told me that he had been working with Professor Masaki Kimura, a marine seismologist at the University of the Ryukyus, Okinawa, who had been studying Yonaguni's mysterious underwater structures since 1994. Kimura, too, was convinced it was man-made. His extensive surveys, sampling, and measurement had shown that it had been hewn out of solid bedrock when the site was still above water. If sea level rise were the only factor to take into account, then provisional calculations would indicate a date of inundation of around 10,000 years ago. That's approximately 5,000 years older than the oldest known monumental buildings on Earth, the ziggurats of ancient Sumer in Mesopotamia. Davy Jones's Locker. I knew that I had to learn to dive and talked my wife Santha into doing lessons with me when we were on a visit to Los Angeles. We took our paddy open water courses in the chill kelpie waters of Catalina Island in November 1996. My first reaction to diving was that it was a weird and scary experience, contrary to the laws of nature, and that I was unlikely to survive it. I was wrapped up like the Michelin man in a full-body neoprene wetsuit, and there seemed to be a ludicrous amount of equipment strapped, velcroed, or clipped onto me. Let's start at the feet. Here the diver wears short rubber boots tucked inside the ankle cuffs of his wetsuit. The wetsuit works by taking in a thin layer of water between the skin and the suit, This is rapidly warm to body temperature and remains warm for some time because the neoprene of the suit is an excellent insulator. Over the boots are strapped the diver's fins, without which he would be almost as clumsy and immobile submerged as he is on land with all his gear on, and would unnecessarily waste a great deal of energy thrashing about. Strapped to his calf, there should be a strong stainless steel knife with a sharp blade. This can be life-saving if you get caught up in a drifting fishnet or some other equally uncompromising, usually man-made hazard. Around the diver's waist is a belt through which are threaded a number of lead weights to compensate for the natural buoyancy of the body and the additional buoyancy of the wetsuit. These days, I can often get away with 2 kilos, but inexperienced divers need a lot more. On my first dives back in 1996 and into the first half of 1997, I remember having to use 12 and in one case even 14 kilos, a horrendous load. Moving on up the body, the next item of equipment the diver wears is a partially inflatable sleeveless jacket called a buoyancy control device, BCD or just BC for short. The scuba tank, which provides the diver with air to breathe underwater, is strapped onto the back of the BC and typically comes in 10, 12, and 15 litre sizes. A mid-sized tank weighs more than 15 kilos, and for most dives is filled with nothing other than normal air under enormous compression. This is delivered to the diver through 2 transformers which step down the pressure of the air to a level where it can be breathed easily. The first stage is mounted immediately on top of the tank and removes most of the pressure. From here, a rubber hose leads to the second stage, or regulator, which is placed in the diver's mouth and provides air on demand. 3 other rubber hoses also emerge from the first stage. One of these connects to the BC, allowing the diver to power inflate it direct from the tank. One leads to a dangling instrument console, usually containing a compass and gauges that tell you how much air you have left and how deep you are. The last, called the octopus, is a spare second stage for use in emergencies, for example, to provide air to another diver whose own tank is empty. Sometimes divers wear a rubber hood, since heat loss from the unprotected head is very rapid. A glass-fronted mask, without which the human eye can only perceive blurred images underwater, covers the eyes and nose. The final major pieces of equipment are a small wrist computer, which can save your life by warning you if you are ascending too fast from depth, and a pair of gloves to keep your hands warm and prevent grazing or accidental contact with unpleasant marine organisms like fire coral. Wrapped up in all this stuff, with our total scuba experience at that time amounting to just 3.5 hours swimming pool dives each, Santha and I contemplated the waters of the Pacific with certain misgivings. To be honest, we were afraid. It looked deep and dark and dangerous down there, down amongst the waving streamers of kelp, down in Davy Jones's locker. But if we wanted to see that incredible underwater structure in Japan for ourselves, then we were going to have to do this. On our instructor's command, we jumped in and paddled out from shore. 4 days later, we were licensed, but definitely not yet experienced enough to dive at Yonaguni. A generous offer. I did not know when we would be able to organize a diving trip to Japan, but knew only that it would be expensive. Then a strange synchronicity occurred. Out of the blue, sometime in January 1997, I received a fax from an American company representing a Japanese businessman. The fax said that the businessman had read Fingerprints of the Gods and would like to invite Santha and me to fly first class to Yonaguni at his expense to explore the island and to dive at the monument. He would ensure our safety by sending a group of top-flight diving instructors with us from the Seaman's Club, a hotel and dive school on the neighboring island of Ishigaki. He would also provide us with a fully equipped dive boat and all other facilities. There were no strings attached to this generous offer, which we accepted. In March 1997, we flew from London to Tokyo and then via Okinawa to Yonaguni to do our first dives there. This was the beginning of a long-term friendship with the businessman whose privacy I protect, and of what began as an informal project to explore, document, and try to understand the sequence of ancient and highly anomalous structures that have been found underwater at Yonaguni and at other islands in southwest Japan. Yonaguni. The first anomalous structure that was discovered at Yonaguni lies below glowering cliffs of the southern shore of the island. Local divers call it Iseki Point, Monument Point. Into its south face, at a depth of about 18 meters, an area of terracing with conspicuous flat planes and right angles has been cut. Two huge parallel blocks weighing approximately 30 tons each and separated by a gap of less than 10 centimeters have been placed upright side by side at its northwest corner. In about 5 meters of water at the very top of the structure, there is a kidney-shaped pool, and nearby is a feature that many divers believe is a crude rock-carved image of a turtle. At the base of the monument, in 27 meters of water, there is a clearly defined stone-paved path oriented toward the east. If the diver follows this path, a relatively easy task, since there is often a strong west-to-east current here, he will come in a few hundred meters to the megalith, a rounded two-ton boulder that seems to have been purposely placed on a carved ledge at the center of a huge stone platform. 2 kilometers west of Iseki Point is the palace. Here, an underwater passageway leads into the northern end of a spacious chamber with megalithic walls and ceiling. At the southern end of the chamber, a tall lintel doorway leads into a second smaller chamber beyond. At the end of that chamber is a vertical rock-hewn shaft that emerges outside on the roof of the palace. Nearby, a flat rock bears a pattern of strange deep grooves. A little further east, there is a second megalithic passage roofed by a gigantic slab that fits snugly against the tops of the supporting walls. 2 kilometers to the east of Iseki Point is Tatagami Iwa, literally the Standing God Stone, a natural pinnacle of rugged black rock that soars up out of the ocean. At its base, 18 meters underwater, there is a horizontal tunnel barely wide enough to fit a diver that runs perfectly straight west to east and emerges amidst a scatter of large blocks with clean-cut edges. A 3-minute swim to the southeast brings the diver to what looks like an extensive ceremonial complex carved out of stone. Here at depths of 15 to 25 meters, there are massive rectilinear structures with sheer walls separated by wide avenues. At the center is the monument that local divers refer to as the Stone Stage. Into its south-facing corner, either man or nature has carved an image that looks to some like a gigantic anthropoid face with 2 clearly marked eyes. Karama. At Aka Island in the Karama group, 40 kilometers west of Okinawa, local divers have been aware for some years of the existence of a series of underwater stone circles at depths of 30 meters. There are also associated rectilinear formations within the same general area that show some signs of having been cut and worked by human beings. Diving conditions at Karama are atrociously difficult, as indeed they are often at Yonaguni too. There is a killer current, but this drops away almost to nothing for approximately an hour between tides. Only in that lull is it possible to get any serious work done and to gain a perspective on the enigmatic structures without constantly having to fight against the sea. Karama's most spectacular feature is Center Circle, which has a diameter of approximately 20 meters and a maximum depth of 27 meters. Here, concentric rings of upright megaliths more than 3 meters tall have been hewn out of the bedrock surrounding a central menhir. A second similar circle, called Small Center Circle by local divers, stands immediately to the northeast. It is not noticeably smaller than the first. A little to the south is Stone Circle, which is made up of much smaller rounded stones. It has a huge diameter of about 150 meters. Within it are subsidiary stone circles, sometimes touching one another at their edges like the links of a chain. Aguni. Aguni Island, 60 kilometers north of Karama, has steep and forbidding cliffs. On the southwest side of the island, these cliffs overlook an area of turbulent water that local fishermen call the washing machine. The turbulence is caused by the presence of a seamount that ascends from much greater depths to form a small plateau only 4 meters under the surface. This plateau, perpetually swept by strong currents, contains a series of circular holes that look initially like well shafts. As they are lined with small blocks, there is little doubt that these shafts are man-made. The largest and deepest has a diameter of 3 meters and reaches a maximum depth below the summit of the seamount of about 10 meters. Others are typically 2 to 3 meters in diameter with a depth of less than 7 meters. A few are narrower and shallower. One has a small subsidiary chamber cut sideways into the wall of the main shaft. Chatan. The coastline around Okinawa has been the subject of intense development during the past half century. 30 kilometers north of the capital, Naha, on the west coast of the island, is the popular resort area of Chatan. Here, less than a kilometer offshore, at depths of between 10 and 30 meters, is strewn a looming underwater fantasia of walls and battlements and step pyramids. Are these weird submerged structures natural or man-made? And if they are man-made, then when and by whom? One possibility suggested to me by local fishermen is that the structures could be artifacts of relatively recent military dredging. Certainly, several large U.S. Air Force bases are located very close to Chatan, and the site is constantly overflown by all kinds of American warplanes doing maneuvers. I still remain open to the possibility that dredging could have produced some of the features to be seen underwater. But against this, I've received a report from Akira Suzuki, a Japanese historical researcher who has carefully investigated both U.S. and Japanese archives in Okinawa and has been unable to find any record of such operations in this area. The most striking of the Chatan structures is a wall with its base on the sandy bottom at a depth of 30 meters. It rises to a battlement with a sunken walkway about 10 meters above the seabed. At a certain point, the walkway is broken by a vertical U-shaped shaft cut through the entire height of the wall. To dive at Chatan is to be reminded of an episode in the Nihongi, one of Japan's most ancient texts, a chronicle of the earliest times. Here, in a long introductory section entitled The Age of the Gods, there is a passage that describes how a deity named Hohodemi no Mikoto climbed into an upended waterproof basket and descended to the bottom of the sea. In this makeshift submarine, he found himself at a pleasant strand. Proceeding on his way, he suddenly arrived at the palace of the sea god. This palace was provided with battlements and turrets and had stately towers. No doubt the many curious things that the Nihongi has to say about the age of the gods may all be explained as mythology and imagination. Still, I find it curious in Japan, where there are so many underwater anomalies, that such a venerable ancient text contains a clear tradition of submerged structures that can only be visited by divers. 15,000 years. Between 1996 and 2000, while I increased my practical diving experience of Japan's underwater ruins, I several times got caught up in the virulent debate about their provenance. Some scholars and journalists think they are entirely natural or mostly natural, Robert Shark of Boston University, for example. Others, such as Professor Kimura and Professor Teruaki Ishii of Tokyo University, remain convinced that they are man-made, but are uncertain as to their antiquity. In addition to sea level rise, complex factors such as possible land subsidence through volcanism, plastic flow, or isostatic rebound must be taken into account when determining the date of submergence of any given site. No early resolution of this debate can be expected, since we are dealing here as much with matters of opinion as with matters of generally agreed fact. Those who think the structures are natural are likely to go on thinking so no matter what the other side says, and vice versa. It looks like a stalemate. Yet there is a potentially fruitful line of inquiry, capable of shedding light on this problem, which neither side has yet considered. Whether they were flooded by rising sea levels or because of some form of land subsidence into the sea, quite possible in an area of great seismic instability like Japan, all the underwater ruins were above water at some point between 17,000 years ago, the end of the last glacial maximum, and 2,000 years ago, the latest date that anyone has suggested for their submergence. What happened in Japan during this 15,000-year period? Could it be that there is something concealed in the remote prehistory of these islands that would provide a context and perhaps even a completely rational explanation for the underwater ruins? Alexandria. During 1998 and 1999, the Egyptian Mediterranean city of Alexandria was much in the news. French archaeologists, led by the melodiously named Dr. Jean-Yves Emperor of the National Center for Scientific Research, had announced the discovery of submerged ruins complete with underwater columns, sphinxes, and granite statues. In the same location, they also claimed to have found the remains of the famed pharos, or lighthouse, 135 meters tall and one of the seven wonders of the ancient world that overlooked Alexandria's eastern harbor from the point where the fort of Mamluk Sultan Kate Bey now stands. Though it was thought to have been built in the early 3rd century BC, historical reports suggest that at least part of the giant lighthouse remained intact until 8 August AD 1303, when a tremendous earthquake struck the Egyptian coast. Researching my earlier books had given me little reason to go to Alexandria. During a decade of travels in Egypt, my focus had always been on the oldest sites, those going back to the 3rd millennium BC and perhaps further. Sites like Giza, with the three pyramids and the Great Sphinx. Saqqara, where the remarkable pyramid texts are inscribed inside the tombs of 5th and 6th dynasty pharaohs. And Abydos, with 1st dynasty boat graves and the mysterious Assyrian. Since it was common knowledge that Alexandria had not existed until 332 BC, the date of its foundation by Alexander the Great, I'd always felt that it was unlikely to hold much of interest to me. I was vaguely aware that it had been built upon the site of an earlier settlement named Rakotis or Rakot. But since this was usually described as an obscure fishing village, I never suspected for a moment that there might be significant traces of earlier monumental constructions in the area. None of the underwater discoveries that were made public at the end of the 1990s did anything to change my view. They too belong to what is called the Ptolemaic period of Egypt, named for the ruling dynasty, of which Cleopatra was the last monarch, established soon after Alexander's death by his general Ptolemy. I was at first intrigued to learn that inscriptions belonging to much earlier pharaohs had been found amongst the underwater ruins, the cartouche of Ramses II, 1290 to 1224 BC, on pink granite papyriform columns from Aswan, an obelisk of his father Seti, 1306 to 1290 BC, a sphinx from the time of Sennacherib III, 1878 to 1841 BC, and numerous other artifacts and objects bearing ancient inscriptions. On good grounds, archaeologists do not regard such discoveries as evidence of any earlier monumental settlement in Alexandria, but rather of a well-known Ptolemaic habit of borrowing pieces of religious art and architecture from temples that had been built throughout Egypt by earlier pharaohs. Jean-Yves Emperor was very clear on this point. The numerous products of the pharaonic period, sphinxes, obelisks, and papyrus columns found underwater around Kate Bey, do not make any significant difference to what we already know about the history of Alexandria and its foundation by Alexander the Great. Diving with Emperor. A research trip to Alexandria was easy to talk myself out of, since what was known of its history was that it had no history before the end of the 4th century BC, there was obviously no good reason for me to go there. The ruins of the pharos, of what looked like an extensive complex of buildings seaward of it, had not been submerged in the period I was interested in, the end of the last ice age, but between the 4th century BC and the 13th century AD, most probably as a result of what geologists call vertical tectonic subsidence caused by earthquakes. Besides, there is a complicated permissions ordeal which one must undergo if one wishes to dive at Alexandria, involving the Ministry of Information, the Ministry of National Security, the Supreme Council of Antiquities, the police, customs, and the Navy. The whole process routinely takes a month. So I'd pretty much quashed the idea before it took shape, when I remembered that my good friend Robert Bovell was born in Alexandria and that several members of his large globe-trotting family were still living there. On a whim, I telephoned him. He lives just outside London, and asked him if he knew anything about Emperor and whether he thought it would be possible to fix up a day of unofficial diving with a French team. Rob is reputed to have worked miracles in Alexandria, even from as far away as England. I therefore wasn't too surprised when he called me back the next day and informed me that he had spoken to his great aunt Fedora, who knew Emperor well. She in turn had put in a good word with the archaeologist. The upshot was that we would be allowed to dive at Kate Bay without formality, any time that suited us in the next few weeks. Sleep of years. On 30 September 1999, Santha and I, hefting our gear, met up with Robert at the gatehouse to Kate Bay Fort. He ushered us inside its medieval limestone walls, soothing the guard in Arabic, and led us to a yard where scuba tanks were laid out and a group of young archaeologists, the men muscular with stubbly chins, the women tanned and serious, were donning wetsuits and checking gear. Emperor, in his late 40s, was older than the rest of his team. He was wearing a tropical linen jacket and a Panama hat, and carrying a briefcase. "Excuse me," he now said as we shook hands, "but I have to rush off, so I won't be diving with you today." "No problem. I'm really very grateful to you for allowing us to do this at all at such short notice." Emperor shrugged. "My pleasure. I hope you enjoy yourselves." He introduced us to the other team members. Then we shook hands again and he strode away. Because it's hard to take notes underwater, I normally document my dives on video. It was my intention to do so now. But as we were getting ready, I was told that this would not be permitted. Santha, likewise, was asked to leave her three Nikonos 5s behind. Apparently it was something to do with an exclusive deal that had been signed with the French photo agency Sigma. Robert protested vociferously on our behalf, and as a compromise, it was ultimately agreed that Santha could use her cameras, but that my video would not be allowed under any circumstances. Once that was settled, we were led down through a series of dank stone corridors with arrow slits overlooking the sea, until we emerged at the edge of the island, long since connected to the mainland by a causeway on which Kate Bay stands. Here we put on our gear and tanks, jumped into the water with one of the archaeologists as our guide, and descended at once into a submarine wonderland less than a dozen meters below us. It may be the most beautiful ancient site I've ever had the privilege to explore. The visibility was poor, which added a kind of foggy glamour to the scene, and we had to crisscross the ruined field many times over three lengthy dives before I began to appreciate how vast and how heterogeneous it was. There were huge numbers of columns, some broken, some virtually intact, but all tumbled and fallen. There were Doric column bases surrounded by tumbled debris. Here and there, one or two courses of a wall could be seen rising up out of the murk. There were dozens of meter-wide hemispherical stones, hollowed inside, of a type that I had never encountered before in Egypt. There were several small sphinxes, one broken jaggedly in half, and large segments of more than one granite obelisk seemed to have been tossed about like matchsticks. There were also quarried granite blocks scattered everywhere. Most were in the 2 to 3 square meter range, but some were much larger, 70 tons or more. A notable group of these behemoths, some a staggering 11 meters in length, lay in a line running southwest to northeast in the open waters just outside Kate Bay. When I researched the matter later, I learned that they were amongst the blocks that Emperor had identified as coming from the Pharos. I learned that they were amongst the blocks that Emperor had identified as coming from the Pharos. Some of them are broken into two or even three pieces, which shows that they fell from quite a height. In view of the location, the ancient writers give for the lighthouse, and taking into consideration the technical difficulty of moving such large objects, it is probable that these are parts of the pharos itself, which lie where they were flung by a particularly violent earthquake. There were exquisite moments when the sun broke through the clouds that lay over Alexandria that day and cast a beam of light down into some dark corner of the submerged ruins. Then the vanquished structures over which we were diving seemed to regather their former stature, like ghosts returning to flesh, before collapsing once again into their sleep of years. Treasure of the Sunken City. A few weeks later, I still hadn't been able to get the images of what I'd seen underwater off Cape Bay out of my mind, or quite rid myself of the feeling that I might have missed something important there. Without any particular objective, I began to buy books about Alexandria and to acquaint myself better with the story of its past. Visiting Amazon.com one evening in mid-October, I found that someone was offering a second-hand copy of Alexandria, a history and a guide written during the First World War and published in 1922 by the British novelist E.M. Forster. I bought it at once, for it is rumored to be a fount of wisdom. There I snapped up in quick succession The Library of Alexandria, Center of the Ancient World, edited by Roy McLeod, Life and Fate of the Ancient Library of Alexandria by Mustafa El Abadi, Philo's Alexandria by Dorothy L. Sly, and The Vanished Library by Luciano Canfora. Oddly enough, Amazon's search engine couldn't immediately find me anything when I entered the keyword pharos. While I was thinking about what to search for next, maybe Seven Wonders of the Ancient World, I called up Jean-Yves Ampere's name to see the complete list of his publications. I already owned his book Alexandria Rediscovered, which told the story of the underwater excavations at Cape Bay, but I hoped that he might have written other books about the region. He hadn't, and I found myself looking at Amazon's sparse sales page for Alexandria Rediscovered. There was one review from a reader in Phoenix, Arizona. He wrote that he wished no disrespect to Dr. Emperor. However, after 17 years as an archaeological diver in Egypt, he could not agree that Emperor's team had found the pharos. What they had found was interesting, yes. Important, yes. But it was definitely not the pharos. What was someone who'd worked for 17 years as an archaeological diver in Egypt now doing in Phoenix, Arizona? And what did he know or think he knew about the pharos? My instincts told me that there could be a story here, and although the reviewer did not give his name, there was an email address. I sent him a message at once explaining my interest in the underwater ruins of Alexandria and asking him to elaborate on his views about the pharos. The next day, 17 October, I received this reply. Mr. Graham, my name is Ashraf Bechai. I'm the former leader of the Maritime Museum underwater team, 1986-89. I'm also a former diving engineer of the Institute of Nautical Archaeology. You can find a little more about me on the Institute webpage. I will be glad to help you with any question you have. Sincerely, Ashraf Bechai, Phoenix, Arizona, USA. Attached was an extraordinary 23-page report titled Treasure of the Sunken City. The truth about the discovery of the lighthouse. Ashraf Bechai's story. What came across in Ashraf Bechai's angry and impassioned report was a sense, above all else, of intellectual outrage. In his view, Jean-Yves Emperor and his team had been altogether too narrow-minded in their interpretation of what they had found underwater at Cape Bay. During the last 3 years, there have been many claims that the French marine archaeological team that has been working underwater in the area of Cape Bay Fort has found the remains of a great building, identified by French and Egyptian archaeologists as the remains of the Pharos Lighthouse. But is it the Pharos? I don't see why we have to take it, as they say, without asking any questions. I don't see why we're expected to suspend our common sense just because this stuff is underwater and looks very spectacular on television. Bechai pointed out that if the pharos had indeed been more than 100 meters tall, as all historical sources maintain, then it must have been a truly enormous building. The Great Pyramid of Giza, for example, which is 150 meters tall, with a base of more than 13 acres, weighs 6 million tons and consists of 2.5 million individual stone blocks. Since the building technology of the 4th century BC was, if anything, inferior to that of the 3rd millennium BC, it is therefore unlikely that the lighthouse, with a reported height of 135 meters, could have had a base area of less than 12 acres or a weight of much less than 5 million tons. Imagine how big the pile of stones that should remain from a building like that, suggested Bichai. Could this great amount of stone just disappear, vanish in the water? The truth is that this much stone would have created an island in the sea, and all the statues, sphinxes, and other ancient Egyptian artifacts that the French team have found, intermingled with the blocks, would have been buried forever under a great pile of rock. Even if one supposes, against the evidence, that a far superior building technology existed in Alexandrian times than in the times of the Great Pyramid, and even if one reduces the height of the pharos from 135 meters to 100 meters, it is still extremely unlikely that it could have been built with less than 500,000 individual stone blocks, as against the pyramid's 2.5 million blocks. But let us reduce it still further, to just 100,000 blocks, or even 50,000. Yet Emperor writes, "As soon as one puts one's head under the water around Cape Bay, one begins to feel dizzy at the sight of 3,000 or so architectural blocks which carpet the seabed." It was precisely this dizzying spectacle of only 3,000 blocks that bothered Bichai. If the ruins around Cape Bay were the remains of the lighthouse and associated structures, then 3,000 blocks was nowhere near enough. 3,000 blocks wouldn't even build a large temple, let alone a lighthouse 100 meters high. And many of the blocks in Emperor's survey are scattered very far from Cape Bay. Some are almost a kilometer away. There's even one 75-ton granite block half a kilometer out to sea and 1.5 kilometers distant from Cape Bay. Are we supposed to believe that the earthquake was powerful enough to throw a 75-ton block as far as that? Bichai also made another valid point. Ancient texts referring to the pharos concurred that it had been built of blocks of white stone, limestone, which is plentiful available locally. Yet the underwater ruin field outside Cape Bay consists primarily of scattered granite blocks and other architectural elements, such as columns, also made out of granite, a much more intractable material that had to be brought to Alexandria from quarries almost 1,000 kilometers to the south. Whilst admitting that limestone does have a much faster rate of erosion than granite, Bichai did not believe that the vast amount of limestone that would have been required for the pharos could possibly all have eroded away. He concluded, "What we have at this site are scattered artifacts from different ages, different designs of blocks, columns, and statues, not an indication of one, but an indication of many things." The giant blocks of Sidi Garba. Before I was halfway through the report, I realized that it pinpointed paradoxes and anomalies that I had completely missed during my dives with a French team. No doubt Emperor would have had answers to all these questions, but at this stage, I had to admit that the questions themselves sounded reasonable. As I read on, I realized that Bichai was agitated about much more than just the problem of the pharos. He wrote, "I have seen things underwater in Alexandria during the last 17 years that challenge all our knowledge of the history of this area." As an example, he reported how in 1984 he had gone spearfishing with some friends offshore of Sidi Garba, a district along Alexandria's crowded corniche, some 3 kilometers to the east of Cape Bay. "We were about 2 kilometers from shore diving off a small boat. I remember that the visibility underwater was exceptionally good. We hadn't been expecting that because there'd been a storm a few days before which moved around a lot of the sand and silt on the bottom. Suddenly I saw hundreds of huge sandstone or limestone blocks laid out in 3 rows, each 2 courses high, that had been exposed on the seabed at a depth of about 6 to 8 meters. The blocks appeared to be of identical dimensions, 4 meters wide by 4 meters long by 2 meters high. They were stacked up on an underwater ridge of some sort because there was deeper water between them and the shore. All around there were hundreds more blocks of similar size that were heavily eroded or damaged or had fallen out of line. This group of blocks had been seen on and off by fishermen and divers over at least 25 years, and there is still no proper explanation for it. I've never been so lucky with the visibility there again, nor the same bottom conditions, and despite many subsequent attempts to relocate the site, I've so far failed to do so. Another interesting site, one that Bichai hadn't seen himself, was the so-called Kanessa, an Arab word meaning church or temple. If you have lived in the wonderful city of Alexandria long enough and had connection with fishermen who do commercial net fishing, then you must have heard about Al-Kanessa. Some say that it is out in the open sea about 1 kilometer to the north of Cape Bay, and that when an east wind blows and the waters are clear, you can sometimes see what look like the remains of a building underwater. Others claim it is much further north, perhaps as much as 5 kilometers out from shore. 3 different people told me very specifically that it is 5 kilometers north to northwest of Cape Bay. Before reaching it, the seabed slopes down to 40 meters, where the bottom is sandy with a few patches of rock. Then you pass an area of rocky pinnacles, some as much as 20 meters high, jutting out of another sandy bed. Then the bottom profile rises up sharply from 40 meters to just 18 meters in depth, creating a smooth-sided, flat-topped hill 5 kilometers from shore in the middle of nowhere. That is where they say the Kanessa is. Mystery of the Sea. After I'd read Ashraf Bachai's report, I began to correspond with him about specific points by email, and in due course we agreed that we would dive together to try to relocate the Sidi Garba blocks and the Kanessa during the summer of 2000. Although his home was now in Phoenix, Arizona, where he ran a business, he told me that he still returned to Alexandria for at least 3 months every year and would be happy to work with me there so long as I could extract the necessary permits from the authorities. There were other travels to do in the meantime. On one trip, I don't remember where, I took E.M. Forster's Alexandria, A History and a Guide with me as airplane reading. In it, I was intrigued to learn that Forster had drawn attention to a report published in 1910 by the French archaeologist Gaston Jondet and entitled Les portes submerged de l'ancienne île de Pharos. According to Jondet, Forster said someone had built a series of huge megalithic walls and causeways some distance off the coast of Alexandria beyond the island of Pharos that were now submerged to a depth of up to 8 meters beneath the sea. The character of these constructions, he judged, was prehistoric. Summarizing reactions to the discovery, Forster wrote, Theosophists, with more zeal than probability, have annexed it to the vanished civilization of Atlantis. M. Jondet inclines to the theory that it may be Minoan, built by the maritime power of Crete. If Egyptian in origin, perhaps the work of Ramses II, B.C. 1300, the construction gives no hint as to nationality or date. It cannot be as late as Alexander the Great, or we should have records. It is the oldest work in the district, and also the most romantic for its antiquity, is added to the mystery of the sea. I wondered how many archaeologists today shared Forster's view about the antiquity and romance of the prehistoric harbour. I knew for sure that Jean-Yves Emperet did not. His on-the-record opinion, in full accord with the mainstream scholarly view, was that before Alexander's arrival, the only inhabitants of the area must have been a few fishermen and perhaps also a garrison stationed here to guard the approaches to the delta. But if so, then who had built the much older and now submerged harbour, if it was indeed a harbour? And how did it fit in, if at all, with the megalithic blocks underwater at Sidi Garba, or the elusive Kanessa that fishermen said appeared and disappeared beneath the sparkling waves? Now you see it, now you don't. like the Sea King's castle. Rumors of the deluge. Descriptions of a killer global flood that inundated the inhabited lands of the world turn up everywhere amongst the myths of antiquity. In many cases, these myths clearly hint that the deluge swept away an advanced civilization that had somehow angered the gods, sparing none but the unlettered and the uncultured, and obliging the survivors to begin again like children in complete ignorance of what happened in early times. Such stories turn up in Vedic India, in the pre-Columbian Americas, in ancient Egypt. They were told by the Sumerians, the Babylonians, the Greeks, the Arabs, and the Jews. They were repeated in China and Southeast Asia, in prehistoric Northern Europe, and across the Pacific. Almost universally, where truly ancient traditions have been preserved, even amongst mountain peoples and desert nomads, vivid descriptions have been passed down of global floods in which the majority of mankind perished. To take these myths seriously, and especially to countenance the possibility that they might be telling the truth, would be a risky posture for any modern scholar to adopt, inviting ridicule and rebuke from colleagues. The academic consensus today, and for a century, has been that the myths are either pure fantasy or the fantastic elaboration of local and limited deluges, caused, for example, by rivers overflowing or tidal waves. It has long been known, commented the illustrious anthropologist Sir J.G. Fraser in 1923, that legends of a great flood in which almost all men perished are widely diffused over the world. Stories of such tremendous cataclysms are almost certainly fabulous, but it is possible and indeed probable that under a mythical husk, many of them may hide a kernel of truth. That is, they may contain reminiscences of inundations which really overtook particular districts, but which in passing through the medium of popular tradition have been magnified into worldwide catastrophes. Unquestioningly following Fraser's lead, scholars to this day still persist in seeing flood stories as recollections, vastly distorted and exaggerated, of real local disasters. There is not one deluge legend, but rather a collection of traditions which are so diverse that they can be explained neither by one general catastrophe alone, nor by the dissemination of one local tradition alone. Flood traditions are nearly universal, mainly because floods in the plural are the most nearly universal of all geologic catastrophes. Not all mainstream academics toe this line. But amongst those who don't, it seems to have been generally agreed that almost any explanation, however harebrained, is more acceptable than a simple literal interpretation of the myth of a global flood, that is, that there actually was a global flood or floods. For example, this from Alan Dundas, professor of anthropology and folklore at the University of California, Berkeley, is regarded as a perfectly acceptable scholarly position on the problem. The myth is a metaphor, a cosmogenic projection of salient details of human birth, insofar as every infant is delivered from a flood of amniotic fluid. My guess is that such thinking will not much longer survive the steady accumulation of scientific evidence, which suggests that a series of gigantic cataclysms, exactly like those described in the flood myths, changed the face of the Earth completely between 17,000 years ago and 8,000 years ago. At the beginning of this period of extraordinary climactic turbulence and extremes, fully evolved human beings of the modern type are thought to have been in existence for 100,000 years, long enough in theory for at least some of them to have evolved a high civilization. While much of the land they formerly lived on is now submerged beneath the sea, and as unfamiliar to archaeologists as the dark side of the moon, how certain can we really be that some of them did not? Dark Zone. SCUBA is the acronym for Self-Contained Underwater Breathing Apparatus, invented by the late Jacques Cousteau and Emile Gagnon in 1943. At first thought likely to be expensive and of use only to specialists, the technology rapidly entered the mass market, and today, scuba diving is the world's fastest growing sport. Although it should be obvious, it is worth remembering that only since scuba diving was introduced has any kind of systematic marine archaeology become possible. Moreover, funds for this kind of research are limited, and the oceans are extremely large, constituting, in fact, more than 70% of the Earth's surface. Marine archaeologists have barely been able to begin the investigation of the millions upon millions of square kilometers of coastal shelf, inundated since the end of the last ice age. As a result, the underwater world continues to constitute a gaping dark zone in human knowledge. It is entirely possible that archaeological surprises and upsets await us there. Question: why has the first extensive evidence of large-scale prehistoric structures beneath the sea come from Japan? Answer: Japan has more scuba divers than any other country, and it follows that its coastal waters have been more thoroughly explored than those of any other country. Question: why have the main underwater structures in Japan all been found south of the 30th parallel? Answer: because most sport divers prefer warm water. There may be structures further north as well, which simply haven't been noticed yet because few divers are attracted to the cold or stormy seas in which they lie. India is the opposite of Japan. It has almost no leisure diving industry, just a couple of dive shops in the whole subcontinent. But it does have marine archaeologists like S.R. Rao, whose minds are open to extraordinary possibilities. Rao's work around Pumpahar was guided by ancient Tamil traditions that speak of the submergence of large masses of land off southern India thousands of years ago. And he himself admits that the U-shaped structure found at 23 meters is hard to explain within the orthodox framework of history. 11,000 years old or older. In August 2000, I took on a new research assistant, Sharif Sakhar, who had just graduated in human sciences from Oxford University. One of the first tasks I gave him was to find me a top-flight academic in Britain who would be prepared to act as a kind of resident expert on sea level rise and who would be qualified to give an authoritative opinion on the date of submergence of almost any underwater structure in the world. Sharif came back to me with Dr. Glenn Milne, a specialist in glacioisostasy and glaciation-induced sea level change at Durham University's Department of Geology. Milne and his colleagues have established a worldwide reputation predicting ancient sea level changes and the corresponding changes in the Earth's coastlines. Their predictions are based on a sophisticated computer model that has been under development since the 1970s and that takes into account many variables beyond changes caused solely by the melting of ice sheets. The technical term is eustasy. In October 2000, Sharif approached Milne on my behalf and asked him to calculate the latest date that the large U-shaped structure and other nearby structures off the coast of Pumpahar could have been submerged. Thursday, 12 October 2000, Sharif Zakhar to Glenn Milne. Hi Glenn, hope everything's okay. Just a quick question. I've got a series of structures 5 kilometers off the southeast coast of India, Tamil Nadu region, probably roughly around 11 degrees north, 80 degrees east, as a rough guess. The structures are 23 meters underwater, which is extremely deep. If we assume only eustatics, then the implication would be that the structures are older than around 7000 BC. But there is also isostatic subsidence to consider. What proportion of that 23 meters depth, as a rough off-the-record guess, could be explained away through subsidence? Does the depth of the structures still suggest great antiquity, even when isostatics are brought into the equation? Thursday, 12 October 2000. Glenn Milne to Sharif Sakhar. Hi Sharif. I did a quick model run for that site, and the predicted sea level curve shows that areas currently at 23 meters depth would have been submerged about 11,000 years before the present. This suggests that the structures you mentioned are 11,000 years old or older. No civilization known to history. Although I could not be certain of anything until I was able to dive on it myself, the early descriptions of the U-shaped structure by the NIO's marine archaeologists left little doubt that it was man-made. The stone blocks and courses of masonry that had been reported by all these experienced witnesses seemed to exclude any possibility that it could be natural or recent, or indeed anything other than the ruins of a very old stone building resting on bedrock constructed here before the ocean rose to cover it. Now, as I studied the email from Glenn Milne, I knew just how ancient the U-shaped structure really might be, at least 11,000 years old. That's 6,000 years older than the first monumental architecture of ancient Egypt or of ancient Sumer in Mesopotamia, traditionally thought of as the oldest civilizations of antiquity. Certainly, no civilization known to history existed in southern India or anywhere else 11,000 years ago. Yet the U-shaped structure off the Tranquebar-Pumpaha coast invites us to consider the possibility that it was the work of a civilization that archaeologists have as yet failed to identify, one whose primary ruins could have been missed because they are submerged so deep beneath the sea. 2. The Riddle of the Antediluvian Cities. And the Lord planted a garden eastward in Eden, and out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight, and good for food. And a river went out of Eden to water the garden. Genesis chapter 2, verses 8 to 10. I think we're going to get many surprises yet on land and under the sea. Thor Heyerdahl, June 2000. Millions of square kilometers of useful human habitat swallowed up by rising sea levels at the end of the Ice Age. Myths of an antediluvian civilization destroyed by global floods. Sightings and rumors of inexplicable submerged structures in many different parts of the world. Could there be a connection? In order to investigate this problem systematically, what I really needed was some method of correlating the facts about land loss at the end of the Ice Age with the localities suggested by the myths and with any eyewitness reports of anomalous underwater structures. I needed, in other words, something like an antediluvian encarta, an electronic atlas of the world as it had looked before, during and after sea level rise that accompanied the end of the Ice Age. Ideally, I should be able to see, on demand, any coastline, any island, any expanse of ocean, as it had looked at millennium intervals throughout the entire period of the meltdown. Such a program, unfortunately, does not exist commercially, nor is information of the extremely specific kind I needed gathered together in any single work of reference. Detailed studies of scattered areas are available, but no comprehensive, time-factored global picture. Yet, as I was to discover, cutting-edge research into post-glacial sea level rise is underway at many universities, and the information necessary to create a useful and reasonably reliable antediluvian atlas does in fact exist, though not in published form. Glenn Milne and his colleagues at the Geology Department of Durham University are the leading UK specialists in the field, and from September 2000 onwards, it was they who came to my rescue. As noted in Chapter 1, the state-of-the-art computer model that they have developed calculates the relevant variables to the extent that they are known and produces printable screen images of any location at any epoch during the past 22,000 years. Since the model does not incorporate tectonic motion and not all its variables are known with great certainty, it is most accurate at predicting shoreline changes in tectonically inactive regions and over time intervals of several centuries or more. Beyond that, its predictions are useful as approximate guides. The processing is not instantaneous, and skilled man-hours are required to extract the required information from the program, location by location. So Glenn was kind beyond measure in cheerfully and helpfully preparing all the inundation maps that are used in the latter chapters of this book. But I had made forays into antediluvian geography before I met Glenn Milne. This was feasible wherever sufficiently detailed sea level data was accessible to build up a sense of how the inundation of a particular region had progressed over a period of several thousands of years. Thanks to the work of Kurt Lambeck, a geologist at the Research School of Earth Sciences of the Australian National University, such data has been on public record for the Persian Gulf since 1996. Lambeck's findings, which I was later able to confirm against Glenn Milne's modelling of the post-glacial shorelines of the Gulf, were of enormous interest to me because the Persian Gulf was the home of a mysterious and extraordinary ancient culture, the Sumerians. Their flood myths seemed to form the archetype for the much later Noah story in the Old Testament, and they are regarded by archaeologists as the founders of the oldest high civilization in the world. Inundation data for the end of the last ice age has never before been thought likely to have a bearing, one way or another, on the problem of the origins of civilization, and has therefore never been used as an investigative tool by archaeologists interested in this problem. But since the relevant data was available for the Persian Gulf, I decided to try to find out what it might show. The five antediluvian cities of Sumer. Located immediately to the northwest of the present coastline of the Gulf, between the Euphrates and Tigris rivers, ancient Sumer flourished during the 4th and 3rd millennia BC, and the earliest surviving written version of the global flood myth was found during excavations of the Sumerian city of Nippur, located on the Euphrates, 200 kilometers south of the modern city of Baghdad. Inscribed on a tablet of baked clay, the Sumerian tradition is accepted by scholars as the source of the later Babylonian epic of Gilgamesh, which likewise speaks of a universal flood that destroyed mankind and also bears a close relationship to the much better-known flood account in the Old Testament. The Sumerian text is from a fragment, the lower third of what was once a six-column tablet. And while it is clear that it belongs to a very ancient and widely dispersed family of flood traditions, it nevertheless remains in itself a unique and unduplicated document. Although scholars have been all eyes and ears for new Sumerian deluge tablets, not a single additional fragment has turned up in any museum, private collection, or excavation. What a rare and precious thing this little slab of baked mud is, and what a tale it has to tell. When I first read it, I was instantly intrigued, because it contains explicit references to the existence of five antediluvian cities, which we are informed was swallowed up by the waters of the flood. If such cities ever existed, then where should we expect to find their ruins today? The first 37 lines of the Sumerian tablet are missing, so we do not know how the story begins, but at the point where we enter it, the flood is still far in the future. We hear about the creation of human beings, animals, and plants. Then another break of 37 lines occurs, after which we find we have jumped forwards in time to an epoch of high civilization. We learn that in this epoch, before the flood, kinship was lowered from heaven, a phrase that is eerily reminiscent of a similar sky-ground symbolism contained in ancient Egyptian scriptures such as the Pyramid Texts, circa 2300 BC. The book of what is in the Duat, circa 1400 BC, and the much later Hermetica, circa AD 300. Then comes the reference to the foundation of Sumer's antediluvian cities by an unnamed ruler or god. After the lofty crown and the throne of kinship had been lowered from heaven, he perfected the rites and the exalted divine laws, founded the five cities in pure places, called their names, apportioned them as cult centers. The first of these cities, Eridu, the second, Betabira, the third, Larak, the fourth, Sippar, the fifth, Shurupak. A flood will sweep over the cult centers. When we rejoin the narrative after a third 37-line lacuna, the scene has changed bewilderingly. Although the flood is still in the future, the foundation of the five antediluvian cities is now far in the past. It is apparent from the context that in the intervening period, the city's inhabitants have behaved in such a way as to incur divine displeasure, and that a convocation of the gods had been called to punish mankind with the terrible instrument of an earth-destroying flood. At the moment where we pick up the story again, a few of the gods are dissenting from this decision and expressing their unhappiness and dissatisfaction with it. Without preamble, a man called Zasudra is then introduced, the Sumerian archetype of the biblical patriarch Noah. The text describes him as a pious, God-fearing king, and allows us to understand that one of the gods, unnamed, has taken pity on him. The god tells Zasudra, "Take my word, give ear to my instructions. A flood will sweep over the cult centers to destroy the seed of mankind. Is the decision the word of the assembly of gods?" A text break of 40 lines follows, which scholars deduce from the many later recensions of the same myth must have continued with detailed instructions to Zasudra to build a giant boat and thus save himself from destruction. When the story resumes, the cataclysm has already begun. All the windstorms, exceedingly powerful, attacked as one. At the same time, the flood swept over the cult centers. For 7 days and seven nights, the flood swept over the land, and the huge boat was tossed about by the windstorms on the great waters. Throughout the cataclysm, the skies remain dark. Then, on the eighth day, the sun breaks through the clouds and the rains and raging storms cease. From the deck of his survival ship, Zasudra looks out over a world that has changed forever and sacrifices an ox and a sheep to the sun god. An infuriating lacuna of 39 lines follows, presumably telling us about the place where Zasudra makes landfall and the steps that he takes thereafter. When we pick up the story again, near the end of the text, we find him in the presence of the high gods of the Sumerian pantheon, An and Enlil, who have repented to their earlier decision to wipe mankind entirely from the face of the earth and are now so grateful to Zasudra for building his ark and surviving the flood that they decide to make him immortal. Life like a god they gave him, breath eternal like a god they brought down for him, Zasudra the king, the preserver of the name of vegetation and of the seed of mankind. The final 39 lines are missing. Picking and choosing. In his classic book, The Sumerians, the late Professor Samuel Noah Kramer, one of the great authorities on ancient Sumer, observes that there are tantalizing obscurities and uncertainties in this oldest surviving written version of the worldwide tradition of the flood. What there can be no doubt about at all, however, is that the tablet speaks of an urban civilization that existed before the flood somewhere in the Persian Gulf area and provides us with the names of its sacred cities, Eridu, Batibira, Larak, Sippar, Shurupak. These cities, we are told quite specifically, were swallowed up in the deluge. Moreover, long after Sumerian civilization itself had ceased to exist, a rich tradition concerning the five cities, the antediluvian epoch, and the flood survived in Mesopotamia almost down to Christian times. Indeed, it is fair to say that the traditional history of this region, as it was told in antiquity, is very clearly divided into two different periods, before and after the flood, and that both periods were regarded by the peoples of the region as absolutely factual and real. It is only later scholars who have picked and chosen from the histories, accepting half of what they say as the basis for orthodox Sumerian chronology and rejecting the other half, concerning the antediluvian period, as myth and fantasy. Their logic is that there's no archaeological evidence for any high urban civilization in Sumer earlier than the 4th millennium BC, and indeed their digs have revealed none. Yet, as the cliché goes, absence of evidence is not necessarily to be taken as evidence of absence, and even Kramer obviously had his doubts. In The Sumerians, he recounts how, before 1952, archaeologists were unanimous in their opinion that Sumer had been uninhabited and uninhabitable marshland until about 4500 to 4000 BC. This figure was obtained by starting with 2500 BC, an approximate and reasonably assured date, obtained by dead reckoning with the help of written documents. To this was added from 1500 to 2000 years, a span of time large enough to account for the stratigraphical accumulation of all the earlier cultural remains down to virgin soil that is right down to the beginning of human habitation in Sumer. But then, continues Kramer, two geologists, Lees and Falcon, published a paper which carried revolutionary implications for the date of Sumer's first settlement. They demonstrated that Sumer had ceased to be uninhabitable marshland long before 4500 to 4000 BC. Now that this was understood, it was not impossible that man had settled there considerably earlier than had been generally assumed. The reason traces of these earliest settlements in Sumer have not yet been unearthed, it was argued, may be because the land is sinking slowly at the same time that the water table has been rising. The very lowest level of cultural remains in Sumer may therefore now be underwater and may never have been reached by archaeologists, since they would have been misled by the higher water level into believing they had touched virgin soil. If that should prove to be true, Sumer's oldest cultural remains are still buried and untapped, and the date of Sumer's very first settlements may have to be pushed back a millennium or so. But why only a grudging millennium or so? Once we've admitted it is possible that archaeologists may never have reached the oldest layers of human habitation in Sumer, why should we assume that further digging might only push the horizon back by 1,000 years? Why not 5,000 years? Or 10,000 years? What is this worship of the recent that archaeologists indulge in? The reason I ask these questions with a certain amount of exasperation is that Kramer, whose work has influenced several generations of students, does not for a moment consider the possibility that Sumer's antediluvian traditions might be based on anything real at all. Indeed, he devotes only 3 pages of his book to the prehistory of this ancient land before giving 30 pages to the historic period, as though all of the former is nothing more than a preamble to the latter. I'm very struck by the extent to which Kramer relies on original Sumerian sources to build up his chronology of rulers, which begins, he says, with the first dynasty of Sumer, whose existence can be historically attested, the so-called first dynasty of Kish, which according to the ancients themselves followed immediately upon the subsistence of the flood. The first ruler of Sumer whose deeds are recorded is a king by the name of Etana of Kish, who may have come to the throne quite early in the 3rd millennium BC. It is in precisely this way that every Sumerian text about the period after the flood is treated as grist to the mill by historians constructing chronologies, while every Sumerian text about the period before the flood is relegated to the realm of the mythologists. So little to go on. Kramer's recognition with the geologists Lees and Falcon that people could have settled in the fertile valley between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers much earlier than had been previously assumed has been entirely vindicated by subsequent discoveries of the traces of primitive agricultural villages dating back more than 8,000 years. But the clues that have come down to us from this remote period are scanty and often ambiguous. For example, with a tiny evidence base, are archaeologists absolutely certain that they could tell the difference between a small group of primitive farmers and a small group of shattered and demoralized survivors from an urban civilization destroyed in a terrible flood? Not a river flood, no matter how big, but a real marine flood, deep and wild and sweeping in over the land, carrying all before it like the one described in the story of Zasudra. Woolley's Deluge. It is a river flood that has traditionally been suggested by scholars as the event described in the Zasudra text. This goes back to the excavations of the renowned British archaeologist Sir Leonard Woolley at the Sumerian city of Ur in 1922-29. Digging inspection trenches through thousands of years of habitation layers, he suddenly reached a layer of silt almost 3 meters deep, which he described as perfectly clean clay, uniform throughout, the texture of which showed that it had been laid there by water. The silt itself was void of habitation evidence, but there were further habitation layers below it that he dated to 3200 BC. Woolley declared that he had found the first concrete proof of the cataclysm described in the Zasudra story and the biblical flood of Noah, and added, "The discovery that there was a real deluge to which the Sumerian and the Hebrew stories of the flood alike go back does not, of course, prove any single detail in either of those stories. This deluge was not universal, but a local disaster confined to the lower valley of the Tigris and Euphrates, affecting an area perhaps 400 miles long and 100 miles across. But for the occupants of the valley, that was the whole world." Woolley may not have been right that the inhabitants of the Tigris-Euphrates River Valley thought of it as the whole world, but he needed to see them as geographically naive in order to explain why they had described his local disaster as a universal flood that threatened the survival of mankind as a whole. Neither was he necessarily right about the riverine nature of his silt layer. Other, more recent voices have suggested that it may have been laid down a few hundred years earlier than he suggested, and that the agency is more likely to have been a massive transgression of the sea, followed by a gradual retreat of the waters with deposition of silt, than the work of the Tigris and Euphrates. Rising Seas. In the 1990s, Kurt Lambeck of the Australian National University carried out a detailed study of the Persian Gulf in order to map and simulate its paleo shorelines from 18,000 years ago, around the end of the last glacial maximum, right up to today. He calculates that the modern shoreline of the region was reached shortly before 6,000 years ago and exceeded, as relative sea level rose 1 to 2 meters above its present level, inundating the low-lying areas of Lower Mesopotamia. This marine transgression, which occurred between approximately 6,000 and 5,500 years ago, flooded the coastal plains of Sumer and extended the northwestern shoreline of the Gulf to the doorsteps of Eridu and Ur, where the rising waters may have temporarily peaked as high as 3 meters above today's level before receding. Geneticist Dr. Stephen Oppenheimer, who has made a special study of floods and ancient migrations, suggests that this could have been the event that left behind the thick inundation deposit that Leonard Woolley excavated at Ur, not a river flood at all, as Woolley had believed, but a marine flood. In his important book Eden in the East, Oppenheimer argues that what happened in the Gulf at this time, between approximately 6,000 and 5,500 years ago, 4,000 to 3,500 BC, was the local effect of a worldwide episode of rapid, relatively short-term flooding known as the Flandrian Transgression, which had a significant impact not only along the shores of the Gulf, but in many other parts of Asia as well. Noting that the destructive effect of the Flandrian Transgression in wiping out coastal archaeological sites up to about 5,500 years ago is now well recognized, he launches the interesting speculation that in the case of Sumer, Eridu may be the oldest coastal city not destroyed by the invading sea. In other words, it could have been the last old city to be built at the post-glacial high water point. Likewise, the distinguished Sumeriologist Georges Roux argues that between 6,000 and 5,000 years ago, the shoreline of the Gulf was approximately 1 or 2 meters above its present level, so that its northwestern coast lay in the vicinity of Ur and Eridu. Thereafter, gradual regression combined with silting from the rivers brought it to where it is now. Eridu. So I was back to the mystery of the antediluvian cities again and how they could possibly have been swept over by the flood, as the Zasudra story claims, when Eridu had so obviously survived into historical times. In fact, as I was soon to learn, all the antediluvian cities had survived into historical times. None of them was presently underwater, and at least one of them, Eridu, appeared never to have been underwater. Between 1946 and 1949, Eridu's ruins, located in the south of Sumer near the Euphrates, a little to the north and west of the modern city of Basra, were thoroughly excavated by a team from the Iraqi Directorate of Antiquities, led by Fuad Safar. The archaeologists paid particular attention to the Temple of Enki, the Sumerian god of wisdom and Eridu's tutelary deity. Here they dug a deep trench through many different layers of construction and reconstruction from about 2500 BC, down until they finally reached the temple's very first building phase. Originally thought to have dated to about 4000 BC, itself an epoch of fabulous antiquity, the excavators kept finding older and older material. The central structure of the site is its principal ziggurat, step pyramid, which was erected around 2030 BC by a Sumerian king named Amar-Sin. But it too turned out to stand on top of a series of earlier structures. Under one of its corners, the archaeologists unearthed the ruins of no less than 17 temples, built one above the other in proto-historic times. The lowest and earliest of these temples, level 17 to 15, were small one-roomed buildings which contained altars, offering tables, and a fine quality pottery decorated with elaborate, often elegant geometric designs. Judging by the pottery, these earliest shrines of Eridu go back much further than 4000 BC and probably as far as 5000 BC, that is, 7000 years ago. That, says George Rue, makes Eridu one of the most ancient settlements in southern Iraq and a remarkable choice in the mythology as the oldest of the antediluvian cities. There therefore seems to be no dispute that there was a settlement of some sort here before the region was flooded by the Flandrian transgression around 5,500 years ago. Yet the excavations, which only stopped when the archaeologists reached virgin soil, yielded no trace of a flood. How could that be explained in an antediluvian city supposedly inundated not just by any old flood, but by the flood? And how was I to make sense of the fact that ancient Ur, less than 20 kilometers away and on slightly higher ground, was not even named in the flood tradition and yet did show evidence of a severe silt-bearing inundation? In 1992, Jules Zarens, a geologist at Southwest Missouri State University, suggested a possible solution to this problem. In a paper published in the Journal of the American Oriental Society, he showed that in spite of Eridu's location in a low-lying depression southwest of Ur, an 8-meter scarp of the Upper Fars formation, the Hazim, runs well to the north and south, possibly blocking any marine infilling into the depression. Now I was better equipped to understand what Oppenheimer and Rue were getting at. Looking at a map of the valley of the Tigris and Euphrates rivers, I could easily see how the relatively small and temporary increase in sea level associated with the Flandrian transgression could have flooded low-lying areas of ancient Sumer, in fact up to about 180 kilometers inland in what are now Iran, Kuwait, and Iraq. This would have brought the northern shoreline of the Persian Gulf very close to Eridu, while quite conceivably carrying it just beyond Ur, thus leaving behind the flood deposit that Woolley had found. Shurupak and Sipar. The archaeological results at the antediluvian city of Shurupak, about 100 kilometers north of Eridu on the Euphrates River, also show evidence of a flood in the form of sizable deposits of waterborne clay and sand due to a major and prolonged inundation. Since Shurupak was renowned as the birthplace of Zasudra, the Sumerian Noah who had preserved the seed of mankind, I thought at first that this might be a promising lead, but it fizzled out. The Shurupak flood was securely dated to 4,900 years ago, probably 600 or 700 years later than the flood recorded at Ur, and was almost certainly riverine. Dedicated to the sun god Utu, Sipar is the furthest inland of all the antediluvian cities and plays a special role in the Sumerian flood story. In fragment 4a of the few scattered remnants of the once widely renowned history of the Babylonian priest Berossus, who wrote in the 3rd century BC, but whose work is thought by scholars to convey authentic Sumerian traditions, Sipar is remembered as the place where the knowledge of the antediluvian race was hidden away before the flood and preserved for use by the survivors of mankind. The Noah figure in this version of the story is named Xisuthros instead of Zasudra. A god visits him in a dream, warns him that humanity is about to be destroyed in a terrible deluge, and orders him to build a huge boat of the usual dimensions in the usual way. So far, this is all very familiar, but then comes a feature not found in the other versions of the tradition. The god tells Xisuthros that he is to gather up a collection of precious tablets inscribed with sacred wisdom and to bury these in a safe place deep underground in Sippar, the city of the sun. These tablets contained all the knowledge that humans had been given by the gods, and Xisuthros was to preserve them so that those men and women who survived the flood would be able to relearn all that the gods had previously taught them. The story of the flood itself is then given, and of the journey of Xisuthros and his protégés in the ark. Immediately after they make landfall, Xisuthros steps down from the great ship, offers a sacrifice to the gods, and then vanishes, having been transported immediately to immortal life. Those who remained on board are now leaderless and confused until a voice is heard from the heavens telling them to sail the ship back towards Babylon and to seek out the city of Sippar, which will have survived the flood. They are to dig up the tablets that were buried there and turn them over to mankind. And those who had arrived in Babylonia dug up the tablets in the city of Sippar and brought them out. They built many cities and erected temples to the gods and renewed Babylon. An uncomfortable feeling. A quick inventory shows that we have so far identified three cities in the Persian Gulf area called Sippar, Shurupak, and Eridu in the historical period, and three counterpart cities with exactly the same names which tradition says existed before the flood. We have Ur, very close to Eridu, which is not spoken of as an antediluvian city, but which clearly suffered a major episode of flooding that laid down almost 3 meters of silt around the middle of the 4th millennium BC. We have Shurupak, which was also inundated not until about 700 years later. Meanwhile, Sippar, the northernmost and farthest from today's Gulf coast of the five antediluvian cities, is named in the Berossus text as a place where it would have been practical for documents buried before the flood to be retrieved after the waters had subsided. The remaining two antediluvian cities of the Sumerian tradition, Batibira and Larak, have also been identified with archaeological sites in Iraq. However, as indeed is the case for Sippar, Shurupak, and Eridu as well, these sites are not particularly large, splendid, or significant as one might expect of such sanctified ground. As William Hallow of Yale University comments, the cities in question are not outstanding in importance. They are distinguished, rather, for their antiquity. Since excavations at Eridu found the earliest occupation layers to have been laid down as much as 7,000 years ago, the city is indeed technically antediluvian by more than 1,000 years with respect to the Flandrian transgression, and the same is already known to be the case at Ur, where Woolley's excavators found habitation traces not only above the flood layer, but also below it. On the face of things, then, it seems reasonable to agree, and many scholars from Woolley onwards have agreed, that it was this flood at this time, or at any rate one of the frequent large-scale floods, both riverine and marine, to which the region was much prone in antiquity, that must have given rise to the Sumerian flood tradition. The new evidence revealing the extent of the flooding of southern Mesopotamia between approximately 4000 and 3500 BC, just on the edge of the historical period, should, if anything, have strengthened this hypothesis. So why didn't I feel comfortable with it? Heyerdahl on Sumer. The floods that had been archaeologically testified in the valley of the lower Euphrates and Tigris took place too soon after the date for the foundation of Eridu and the other antediluvian cities to fit in with the sense of grandeur and vast age that the traditions conveyed. When I looked again at the story of Sasudra, the story of the Babylonian flood hero Atrahasis, the Epic of Gilgamesh, the fragments of Berossus, and numerous other recensions and variants, I found that all of them set the antediluvian city building period in the frame of vast expanses of time, frequently running into tens of thousands and even hundreds of thousands of years. While I could understand why William Hallow felt that this chronology, measured in millennia, is obviously fantastic, I found his own proposed chronology equally absurd. Mesopotamian urbanism, he argued in the prestigious Journal of Cuneiform Studies, was only some 2 centuries old at the time of the flood. In June 2000, I met the explorer and adventurer Thor Heyerdahl, then 86 years old, at the excavation of a group of step pyramids on Tenerife in the Canary Islands. We spent the afternoon together under the blazing sun, exploring the site that he had brought to world attention. Heyerdahl was everything I expected him to be, impatient with protocol, a powerful presence with piercing blue eyes, endearing vanities, a bawdy sense of humor, and an open, inquiring, restless mind. His Tigris expedition in 1977, which had begun in the Persian Gulf and culminated in Djibouti in the Horn of Africa, had proved that the reed boats of ancient Mesopotamia were sufficiently seaworthy and technically advanced to make long-distance marine voyages. Evidence of transoceanic trade at the very beginning of Sumerian history suggested very strongly that they had indeed made such voyages as early as the 4th millennium BC, and perhaps even earlier. Moreover, wherever archaeologists excavate, they find amidst the ruins of Sumer's most ancient cities all the signs of a civilization that was already highly evolved, accomplished, and sophisticated when those cities were founded more than 5,500 years ago. "Now we know that man is more than 2 million years old," exclaimed Heyerdahl. "It would be very strange if our ancestors lived like primitive food collectors for all that time until suddenly they started in the Nile Valley, in Mesopotamia, and even in the Indus Valley to build a civilization at peak level pretty much at the same time." And there's a question I ask that I never get an answer to. The tombs from the first kingdom of Sumer are full of beautiful ornaments and treasures made of gold, silver, platinum, and semi-precious stones, things you don't find in Mesopotamia. All you find there is mud and water, good for planting, but not much else. How did they suddenly learn, in that one generation just about, where to go to find gold and all these other things? To do that, they must have known the geography of wide areas, and that takes time. So there must have been something before. I pointed out that the first dynasty of Sumer defined itself as the first dynasty after the flood. The historical Sumerians had always believed that their history was connected to an earlier episode of city building and civilized life that had begun many thousands of years in the past, and from which this deluge separated them. "We're coming to a controversial idea," I suggested, "which is that the great civilizations of historical antiquity may have received some kind of legacy from an antediluvian culture, an idea orthodox archaeologists detest." "I know that," Heyerdahl replied, "but I mean they cannot give any answer to how the Sumerians 5,000 years ago know where to go and find these different kinds of raw material. They must have known the world. So, and I mean it, it is for me almost as fantastic as Erich von Däniken, who brought in people from space to say, as archaeologists do, 'Oh no, no, they sat in Egypt and Mesopotamia and the Indus Valley, and they decided, bang, suddenly just like that, we're going to build pyramids, we're going to go and find gold, and we're going to do all this. It's ridiculous. I say it straight out. It could not be possible." The idea of a lost civilization drives archaeologists mad, and they seem to want to stop people thinking about it. Well, I understand why. Too many people have brought this up together with fairy tale stories, which has put the historians off, so that they simply never explore this kind of question. Yes, and this is a great pity, because I mean even the sunken Atlantis story, which they all dismiss, is interesting. Because why did the early Greeks write this story, and why did they get it from the Egyptians? And for that matter, why does every civilized and half-civilized nation in the world talk about the flood? Don't let us throw it away until we know that this is impossible. There has to be a possibility, and I think that we should look for it with the modern technical means we have. I think we are going to get many surprises yet on land and under the sea. No surprises what the archaeologists say about before. Heyerdahl had arrived at his misgivings about the orthodox chronology of Sumer because he felt that it did not allow time for the evolution and development of the advanced urban civilization that archaeologists now know had flourished there from the 4th millennium BC. There has to have been something before, he reminded me when we parted. Look for whatever was before. Of course, there had been something before, a well-worked-out stratigraphical sequence that traced the development of human civilization in Mesopotamia back through proto-history, before the early dynastic period, and thence into Neolithic, Mesolithic, and even Paleolithic epochs, a long, gradual, unsurprising process spread out over 30,000 years that Georges Roux sums up as from cave to farm and from village to city. At risk of grossly abbreviating the painstaking archaeological work that has gradually uncovered this sequence, here are a few of the main mileposts. Shonadar Cave in the Kurdish mountains of what is now northern Iraq, occupied by Neanderthal man circa 50,000 years ago to 46,000 years ago, occupied by anatomically modern Upper Paleolithic humans around 34,000 years ago, occupied by Mesolithic peoples around 11,000 years ago. Jarmo, also in northern Iraq, a Neolithic agricultural site which may perhaps date as early as 8,750 years ago. It has a 7-meter-high artificial mound resting on top of a very steep hill and is formed of 16 layers of superimposed habitations. Hassuna, again in northern Iraq, 35 kilometers south of Mosul. The first settlement here has the appearance of a more primitive Neolithic farming community living in huts or tents. Overlying this layer, archaeologists found 6 layers of houses, progressively larger and better built. Der Baghir, about 8,000 years ago, more sophisticated features found, including beautiful murals and floors made out of large clay slabs, carefully plastered with gypsum and frequently painted red. The Samarra period, named after a widespread pottery style created by what Roux describes as a hitherto unsuspected culture which flourished in the Middle Tigris Valley during the second half of the 6th millennium BC, that is, approximately 7,500 years ago. The geneticist Luca Cavalli-Sforza suggests that this date should be pushed back to about 8,000 years ago. There is evidence that this culture used irrigation techniques, grew large surpluses of wheat, barley, and linseed, and built spacious houses out of mud brick, later the favored method of construction in the cities and temples of historical Sumer. As well as Samarra, several other proto-historical cultural phases have been identified in which elements of Sumer's future civilization can be witnessed taking shape in increasingly organized and recognizable forms. Two of these phases stand out prominently in the archaeological record. The Ubaid period, roughly 7200 to about 5500 years ago, and including the first temple at Eridu, and the Uruk period, 6,000 years ago down to about 5200 years ago, showing further developments in the evolution of temple architecture. The Uruk period, which some archaeologists prefer to see as a subdivision of the Ubaid, then merges fairly seamlessly into the early dynastic period of Sumer. All of these dates are, of course, approximate and are subject to processes of continuous revision and refinement by scholars. Nevertheless, they are thought likely to be accurate to within about 300 years. In general, the academics also agree that the direction of the flow of the urban lifestyle in Mesopotamia is from north to south, with the first village-style settlements and large houses established in the north before being seen in the south. However, and paradoxically, Sumerian civilization as a distinctive entity, the origins of which archaeologists now trace back at least as far as the Ubaid period, if not further, appears to be a phenomenon that had its origins in southern Mesopotamia. According to Georges Roux, During the 4th millennium BC, the cultural development already perceptible during the Ubaid period proceeded at a quicker pace, and the Sumerian civilization finally blossomed. This, however, took place only in the southern half of Iraq, the northern half following a different course and lagging behind in many respects. The word Sumerian is derived from Shumer, the ancient name of southern Iraq. Archaeologists believe that they have distinguished the presence of three distinct ethnic groups living in close contact in this region at the dawn of history around 5,000 years ago. These were the Sumerians, predominant in the extreme south from approximately Nippur near modern Diwaniya to the Gulf, the Semites, predominant in central Mesopotamia, the region called Akkad after 2400 BC, and a small diffuse minority of uncertain origin to which no definite label can be attached. Apparently, the only distinguishing features of these three groups are their languages. Otherwise, all of them had the same institutions, all of them shared the same way of life, the techniques, the artistic traditions, the religious beliefs, in a word, the civilization which had originated in the extreme south and is rightly attributed to the Sumerians. The Sumerian problem. With so much known about the evolution and development of the magnificent urban civilization of Sumer, it comes as a surprise to discover that there is such a thing as the Sumerian problem. I prefer to let the scholars speak for themselves. Who are these Sumerians? Do they represent a very ancient layer of population in prehistoric Mesopotamia, or did they come from some other country, and if so, when did they come and whence? This important point has been debated again and again, ever since the first relics of the Sumerian civilization were brought to light more than a century ago. The most recent discoveries, far from offering a solution, have made it even more difficult to answer. And there is a mystery about the Sumerian language. It can be read and studied because later civilizations, such as the Babylonians, kept archives of Sumerian texts and also helpfully translated them into their own languages. However, Sumerian has a distinct peculiarity. It is unrelated to any of the known language families of the world. So, although there is a real sense in which Sumer and its precocious urban culture fit in very nicely with long-term developmental trends in ancient Mesopotamia, as I believe the scholars have successfully demonstrated, there is also a sense in which the Sumerians are definitely a bit different, a bit special, and conspicuously attached to the south. I've been dealing with archaeologists long enough now to realize that they don't like myths or traditions very much. Can't weigh them, can't measure them, can't carbon date them. I was therefore not surprised to learn that they discounted what the Sumerians themselves had to say about their own origins. Sumerian literature presents us with a picture of a highly intelligent, industrious, argumentative, and deeply religious people, but offers no clue to its origins. Sumerian myths and legends are almost invariably drawn against a background of rivers and marshes, of reeds, tamarisks, and palm trees, a typical southern Iraqi background, as though the Sumerians had always lived in that country, and there is nothing in them to indicate clearly an ancestral homeland different from Mesopotamia. But as we have seen, the Sumerians had very clear ideas about their own origins. In their myths and legends, they remembered a time before the flood when they had lived in five great cities, and they remembered a deluge so ferocious that it threatened the existence of all mankind. The Seven Sages, what the Sumerians said about before. Sumerian myths and legends of the antediluvian world do much more than speak of the five cities. They also tell an extraordinary story of how their ancestors, who lived in the most ancient times, were visited by a brotherhood of semi-divine beings described as half-men, half-fish, who had been sent by the gods to teach the arts of civilization to mankind before the flood, and who had themselves emerged from the sea. The collective name by which these creatures were known was the Seven Sages, and the name of their leader was Oannes. Each of them was paired as a counselor to an antediluvian king, and they were renowned for their wisdom in affairs of state and for their skills as architects, builders, and engineers. The priest Berossos compiled his history from the temple archives of Babylon, reputed to have contained public records that had been preserved for over 150,000 years. He had passed on to us a description of Oannes as a monster or a creature. However, what Berossos had to say, ridiculous though it may sound, is surely more suggestive of a man wearing some sort of fish costume. There is also a geographical anomaly in the text that may prove worthy of further consideration. They appeared from the Red Sea in an area bordering on Babylonia, a frightening monster named Oannes. It had the whole body of a fish, but underneath and attached to the head of the fish, there was another head, human, and joined to the tail of the fish, feet like those of a man, and it had a human voice. Its form has been preserved in sculpture to this day. This monster spent its days with men, never eating anything, but teaching men the skills necessary for writing and for doing mathematics and for all sorts of knowledge. How to build cities, found temples, and make laws. It taught men how to determine borders and divide land, also how to plant seeds and then to harvest their fruits and vegetables. In short, it taught men all those things conducive to a civilized life. Since that time, nothing further has been discovered. At the end of the day, this monster, Oannes, went back to the sea and spent the night. It was amphibious, able to live both on land and in the sea. Later, other monsters similar to Oannes appeared. Did they come from the east? In 1944, Benno Landsberger, one of the great Sumerian scholars of the 20th century, commented in an obscure essay that, in his opinion, the legend of the seven sages who, emerging from the sea, imparted all technical skills and all knowledge to the Babylonians may quite possibly have some historical basis. What he had in mind here was the Sumerian problem, that is, the as yet unanswered question, where did the Sumerians come from? Earlier than most archaeologists, he fully understood that the essential civilizing process on Mesopotamian soil must be ascribed to pre-Sumerian population. But at the same time, the Sumerians were distinctively different and much more advanced than their immediate neighbors in terms of the level of development of their intellectual and philosophical ideas. In the area of intellectual culture, he wrote, only the Sumerians possessed creative powers. In fact, they were so different in this respect that Landsberger was convinced they must have been migrants from somewhere else. He felt that only such a migration could account for the creation of the unique and idiosyncratic early dynastic culture, which is considered to be so specifically Sumerian and which in its later manifestations indeed represented the Sumerian essence in its purest state. In all probability, the Sumerians came from the east. Not only does the density of the settlement indicate a settling from south to north, but the absence of Sumerian elements in the mountain ranges north and east of Babylonia favors the thesis that the Sumerians came across the sea. In further support of his thesis, Landsberger pointed out that the island of Bahrain, in the south of the Persian Gulf near Qatar, possessed deities with authentic Sumerian names, such as the chief god Enzak and his spouse, Mesilak. This circumstance supports an overseas origin for the Sumerians, since it is improbable that the island was colonized from southern Mesopotamia. Landsberger went on to speculate that the spark of Sumerian genius might have been imported from the Indus Valley civilization across the Arabian Sea to the east, an interesting idea in itself. However, because he was writing in the 1940s, he did not have access to modern knowledge about the astonishing changes that took place in the Persian Gulf at the end of the last ice age. He was thus unable to consider a far more radical possibility that the new science has revealed. Explosive implications. Kurt Lambeck's work on the Persian Gulf initially drew my attention because it spoke of a marine flooding incident, the Flandrian transgression between about 6,000 and 5,500 years ago, that temporarily shifted the northern coast of the Gulf more than 150 kilometers inland and made Ur and Eridu beachfront property. Lambeck's study was published in 1996 in the Earth and Planetary Science Letters, a specialist geological journal that probably does not cross the desks of a great many archaeologists. He had focused on the period from 18,000 years ago, around the peak of the last glaciation, until today, and had taken into account all the key variables, including the response of the Earth to glacial unloading of the distant ice sheets and to the meltwater loading of the Gulf itself and the adjacent ocean. Models for these glacio-isostatic effects have been compared with observations of sea level change, and paleo-shoreline reconstructions of the Gulf have been made. Now, as I looked more closely into Lambeck's research, I realized that it could have unexplored and potentially explosive implications for the prehistory of Sumer. From the peak of the glaciation until about 14,000 years BP, years before the present, the Gulf is free of marine influence out to the edge of the Birbin Shelf. By 14,000 year BP, the Strait of Hormuz had opened up as a narrow waterway, and by about 12,500 years ago, the marine incursion into the central basin had started. The western basin flooded about 1,000 years later. Momentary standstills may have occurred during the Gulf flooding phase at about 11,300 and 10,500 year BP. In other words, the whole of the Persian Gulf, in fact to a point well beyond the Strait of Hormuz in what is now the Gulf of Oman, was dry land between 18,000 and 14,000 years ago. Only then did the sea begin to transgress into the Gulf itself, first as a narrow waterway, later as a recurrent cycle of powerful short-lived floods, each followed by a partial recession of the floodwaters, then a standstill, then renewed flooding at irregular intervals. I knew from my first encounter with Lambeck's research that the present shoreline of the Gulf had been reached and then temporarily exceeded around 5,500 years ago during the Flandrian transgression. But what I had not immediately understood was the extraordinary geological drama that had unfolded between 14,000 years ago when the Gulf first began to flood and 7,000 years ago when the city-state of Eridu was established at the northwestern end of the Gulf, and along with it, the way of life that would soon flower as Sumerian civilization. The floor of the Gulf. Lambeck himself was convinced that there must be some connection between the flooding of the Gulf and the Sumerian problem. The early record is incomplete and numerous questions have been raised. Who were the Sumerians? Where did they come from? When did they arrive? Did they arrive from a mountainous region beyond Iraq, or did they arrive by sea? Were they descendants from earlier Neolithic settlers in the region, from the Ubaid culture at 4500 to 3500 BC, or from even earlier Eridu culture at about 5000 BC? Archaeologists often refer to the Eridu culture as Ubaid I, that is, the earliest stage of the Ubaid culture. Whatever directions the search for answers to such questions may take, a significant element in the puzzle must be the evolution of the physical environment of the Gulf itself. The last observation sounded particularly relevant to my concerns. However, Lambeck went on to qualify it by suggesting that the only epoch that historians and archaeologists really need to pay attention to is the latter period of the flooding of the Gulf and the subsequent flooding of the low-lying delta region, the Flandrian transgression, when sea level rose perhaps a few meters above its present level between 6,000 and 3,000 year BP. If archaeologists were interested in the earlier period between 18,000 years ago down to as recently as 7,000 years ago, when a large part of the Gulf floor was still dry land, then they should focus on its role as a corridor of migration, a natural route for people moving westwards from east of Iran. Is this the route traveled by the ancestors of the Sumerians? What Lambeck did not do anywhere in his paper was invite consideration of another possibility, even though it is suggested by some of his own data. This is the possibility that the dry floor of the Gulf could itself have been a place of permanent settlement at some point during the 11,000 years between 18,000 and 7,000 years ago. If it was, then why shouldn't an urban culture have evolved here, just as the myths of the antediluvian cities suggest? After all, Orthodox archaeology has already accepted the existence of very ancient cities elsewhere in the Middle East, such as Katil Hayek in Turkey, at least 8,500 years old, Jericho in Palestine, more than 10,000 years old, and indeed Eridu in Mesopotamia, where, as we have heard, the oldest shrines are thought to be about 7,000 years old. Knowing the inundation history of the Gulf as well as we do now, therefore we cannot rule out the possibility that the ruins of the cities that are literally antediluvian could be concealed beneath its increasingly polluted, industrialized, and militarized waters. A river ran through it. During the period from the last glacial maximum until about 10,000 years ago, the Ice Age world was generally colder and more arid than it is today, with average temperatures depressed by several degrees even in tropical and equatorial zones. However, these conditions are likely to have been much less severe within the micro-region of the antediluvian Gulf, essentially a large, well-protected low-lying valley. Its notable feature, which undoubtedly would have been a magnet for life of all sorts, including human beings, was that the Tigris and the Euphrates flowed through it, united as a single mighty river. The river's course seems to have run along the northern side of the valley, and at different periods appears to have passed through as many as three large freshwater lakes in the Gulf's western and central and eastern basins. It exited the Gulf through the narrows now known as the Strait of Hormuz and formed its delta on the Biabin Shelf to the east. The delta was relatively small for such a large river, which suggests to scientists that it must have dumped most of its load of fertile alluvial silt in and around the shores of the lakes that it filled along the way. Over thousands of years, this would have created areas of great natural fertility within the valley where agriculture, if practiced, might have been extremely productive. For a while, things could only get better, and despite the remorseless advance of the sea after the Strait of Hormuz was breached 14,000 years ago, conditions in the rest of the Gulf may for a long while have remained extremely pleasant. I was particularly interested to learn of a comprehensive study done in 1988 by the COMAP group, which showed that the Indian monsoon system penetrated into the southern and eastern portions of Southwest Asia during the period from 12,000 to 9,000 years ago, and then retreated. The implication was that throughout this period, the Gulf, along with other parts of Southwest Asia, would have enjoyed both winter rains and in some areas also summer rains or ephemeral summer storms. This rainfall would have increased grazing opportunities, particularly in semi-arid areas, but would have had little effect on the growth of winter cereals that formed a principal base of early agriculture. A protected valley, a great river, lakes, fertile soils, bountiful rainfall, the paleoclimatological literature left me with the distinct impression that the Gulf around 10,000 or 12,000 years ago could have been a very unusual place. Indeed, a secret garden blessed with an ideal climate, offering nearly optimum conditions for the emergence of a civilization. A sea change. What changed everything was the sea. As Lembeck tells it, by 14,000 year BP, the Hormuz Strait had opened up as a narrow waterway, and the flooding of the lowlands to the west begins first with the flooding of the eastern basin by marine water soon after 13,000 BP. Marine influence is first experienced in the central basin before about 12,500 BP. The western basin lake remains free from marine incursion until about 11,500 BP. The northern part of the Gulf remains dry at this time, as does a vast area south of the Paleo Gulf, although this plain contains numerous shallow topographic depressions. Until about 11,000 BP, the northern part of the Persian Gulf floor would have been a relatively flat but narrow plain, hemmed in between the Paleo Gulf and the southern foothills of the Zagros Mountains, forming the present coastline. As the sea level rises, the Gulf continues to expand and the marine influence spreads into the northern region. By about 10,000 BP, the northeast margin of the Gulf has approached its present position in several localities, particularly east of about 52 degrees longitude. Much of the southern part of the Gulf remains exposed until about 8,000 BP, and areas such as the Great Pearl Bank are not submerged until shortly after this time. I've deliberately chosen not to summarize Lambeck's blow-by-blow account of the flooding of the Gulf, but to let him speak for himself. He does not dramatize or interpret his data, but presents it neutrally, without speculation, as a good scientist should. I am not a scientist, but I have a different approach. What I see here is first and foremost a mystery, the mystery of Sumerian origins, the Sumerian problem, as archaeologists like to call it. When I look closely, I find that not only do we not know where the Sumerians came from, but also that their language is unique in the world, apparently unrelated to any other known language. Closer up still, and I learn that the Sumerians preserved traditions of a terrible flood that had nearly obliterated mankind from the earth, and that had inundated the five antediluvian cities of their ancestral homeland. There had been survivors in a great ship who had been carried by the floodwaters to another land and had settled there in order to renew the ruined earth, replenish the seed of mankind, and preserve the ancient wisdom and the worship of the gods. For this reason, those who later traced their line and religion from these survivors always remembered history as being divided into two periods, before and after the flood, and recorded the dynasties of their rulers in exactly the same way, with a list of the historical kings preceded by the list of the antediluvian kings, the latter reigning for a very long period. I review the archaeological literature for rational explanations of the Sumerian flood tradition and find that most of the experts agree it must have been rooted in some kind of historical truth. They point to the temporary inundation of Ur around 5,500 years ago, either by gigantic river floods or by the marine incursion known as the Flandrian transgression. But when I look further and try to match up the details of the flood tradition to the archaeological facts, I find that nothing really fits. Nevertheless, there are strange resonances between the evidence and the myths. For example, we've heard that Eridu, always named as the first and oldest of the antediluvian cities, was never flooded. Yet the archaeological evidence does make it a strong contender, with its 7,000-year-old shrines to the water god Enki, for the title of oldest Sumerian city. Conversely, Ur, which is not mentioned in the flood tradition at all, was most definitely flooded around 5,500 years ago. Shurupak, which is named as one of the antediluvian cities, was likewise flooded, but not until 700 years later. So, for me, the theory that connects the Sumerian flood tradition with whatever event it was that flooded Ur is a dog that don't hunt. I would honestly sooner conclude that the Sumerians had made the whole thing up than agree that they were so geographically ignorant and historically naive that they were incapable of distinguishing between a universal flood capable of wiping out humanity and a local flood, however large. Since we respect them so highly in other departments, as the builders of the world's first schools, for example, the inventors of the world's first bicameral Congress, the compilers of the world's first law codes, etc., shouldn't we also respect the Sumerians' own evaluation of the Great Deluge that they say swallowed up the cities of their ancestors so long ago in the past? A new hypothesis. Then I come across Kurt Lambeck's data. What it tells me is that the floor of the Persian Gulf was entirely exposed until as recently as 14,000 years ago, that between 12,000 and 9,000 years ago, it would have been a veritable Garden of Eden, and that, despite continuous flooding, large areas of the Gulf floor remained above the waves until somewhere between 8,000 and 7,000 years ago. Since these included the Great Pearl Bank between modern Dubai and Qatar near Bahrain, I find it difficult to believe it is a coincidence the deities with authentic Sumerian names were worshipped in ancient Bahrain or that the first definite evidence of an identifiably Sumerian presence in Iraq is at Eridu, around 7,000 years ago, so soon after the Great Pearl Bank was inundated. In short, although I stress again that I'm no scientist, I believe that Kurt Lambeck's data is strong enough to justify an entirely new hypothesis on the subject of the Sumerian problem. I think it's time to consider seriously the possibility that the true story of Sumerian origins may have proved so elusive because it is veiled beneath the waters of the Persian Gulf. In that case, Eridu and the other four antediluvian cities of Mesopotamia might well bear the same relationship to the original antediluvian cities of the Gulf floor as Halifax, Nova Scotia, bears to Halifax, England, or as Perth, Australia, bears to Perth, Scotland. They could, in other words, have been named in memory of other older cities somewhere else. Normal, well-testified behavior by migrants of almost all cultures in every epoch. Moreover, in this case, we are not even required to imagine that the migration came from very far away, but merely from the flooded lowlands of the Gulf towards the nearest higher and productive ground that was blessed by the same Tigris-Euphrates river system as the floor of the Gulf had once been. At this point, I find that the hypothesis and the existing archaeological evidence begin to converge nicely. Yes, it seems to be true that Eridu stands out as one of the earliest nascent cities of Sumer. Yes, the date of submersion of the Great Pearl Bank coincides quite closely with the date of foundation of the first shrines to Enki at Eridu, and yes, the Sumerians did have distinctive memories of an advanced antediluvian culture that had been destroyed by a great flood. But still, the flooding of the Gulf was a long-term event, wasn't it, spread out over more than 6,000 years? Surely something that gradual, that predictable, is no more likely than the localized flooding around Ur 5,500 years ago to have inspired the Sumerian tradition of the sudden world-destroying flood that threatened the survival of mankind. Before I attempted to test my Sumerian hypothesis further by trying to set up a proper diving expedition in the Gulf, written authorization required in triplicate from Saddam Hussein, the U.S. Navy, the CIA, Texaco, the President of Iran, the King of Saudi Arabia, and the Emirs of Kuwait, Bahrain, Qatar, Sharjah, Abu Dhabi, and Dubai, I decided that I had to learn more about the behavior of the world's oceans in the key 7,000-year period from roughly 14,000 to 7,000 years ago. I knew already that this had been the peak period of the meltdown of the last ice age. I knew already that it had been a period of great turbulence and instability. It was therefore by no means impossible that something had happened at the global level during these millennia that could have projected a true cataclysmic flood into the sheltered valley of the Gulf. In fact, as I was to discover, it could have happened more than once. 3. Meltdown. Athenian, do you consider that there is any truth in the ancient tales? Clinius, what tales? Athenian, that the world of men has often been destroyed by floods, in such a way that only a small portion of the human race survived. Clinius, everyone would regard such accounts as perfectly credible. Plato, Laws, Volume 1, Book 3. It is clear that the Beverly Lake drumlins must have been submerged in the formative flow. Minimum depths of about 20 meters were required. On a helicopter traverse across the north shore of Georgian Bay, a single field of bedrock erosional marks was noted that had a width of at least 50 kilometers. These drumlins and erosional marks indicate meltwater floods that were competent to remove the largest boulders. Flow widths equal to the widths of drumlin and erosional mark fields were in the range of 60 to 150 kilometers. Volumes of water required to sustain such floods would have been of the order of 1 million cubic kilometers, equivalent to a rise of several meters in sea level over a matter of weeks. John Shaw, Professor of Earth Sciences, University of Alberta. As recently as 20,000 years ago, North America had an array of large animals to rival the spectacular wildlife of modern Africa. Mammoths, bigger than African elephants, as well as smaller, pointy-toothed mastodons, ranged from Alaska to Central America. Herds of horses and camels roamed the grasslands, while ground sloths the size of oxen lived in the forests and bear-sized beavers built dams in the streams. By about 10,000 years ago, all of these animals, and others such as American lions, cheetahs, saber-toothed cats, and giant bears, were gone. Some 70 North American species disappeared, three-quarters of them large mammals. Why? Washington Post, 21 November, 2001. If you study the literature and talk to the experts on the last ice age, you will find that there are wide differences of opinion over such fundamental matters as the main sequence of events, the chronology and consequences of these events, and even the terminology used to describe them. The very idea of the last ice age is poorly defined and is used differently by different authorities. For some, it refers to the period from roughly 125,000 years ago, when the ice caps of the Northern Hemisphere began their most recent advance, down to about 21,000 years ago, when they reached their maximum extent, LGM, the last glacial maximum, and then began to melt. Even here, though, there seems to be variation in the scientific literature, as I've seen the LGM dated as early as 25,000 years ago and as late as 18,000 years ago. Another school of semantics takes a longer view, pointing out that the last ice age was merely the most recent surge in a boom-and-bust cycle of glaciations and deglaciations going back some 2.6 million years. To them, it is this longer cycle that is the ice age, and it is not the last ice age, because we are still in it. They point out that the process of deglaciation after 17,000 years ago was extremely rapid, being largely over within 10,000 years, but not far beyond the norm set by previous deglaciations. Likewise, the relatively congenial conditions that we have enjoyed during the 7,000 years since then are perhaps a little better than those in some previous interglacials, but not spectacularly so. Although I am not concerned in this inquiry with epochs millions of years in the past, I note in passing how curiously the fortunes of the creature called man seem to be intertwined with the long chronology of the Ice Age. The traces of our earliest upright walking ancestors of the genus Homo first began to appear in the fossil record about 2.6 million years ago, when the great cycle of the current Ice Age began. Another coincidence occurs approximately 125,000 years ago, the onset of the most recent surge of the ice sheets. It is at about this time, or a little after, that the earliest remains of possible anatomically modern humans are found. The earliest undisputed remains of anatomically modern humans are much more recent, perhaps 40,000 years ago. This is around the same time that the first traces of classic European cave art begin to appear, already mature and fully formed in such locations as the Chauvet Cave in France. The earliest undisputed remains of large-scale permanent settlements with monumental stone architecture are found around 10,000 years ago. Jericho, for example, which stands in the Jordan Valley in Palestine. Other impressive sites include Katel Hayek in Turkey, dating to perhaps 8,500 years ago. The whole idea of permanent settlement, however, does not seem to take very wide root until after about 7,500 years ago. This is the time when the world's climate begins to stabilize again after 10,000 years of unbelievable turbulence, melting ice, and rising sea levels. The same chronology, more or less, and the same loose correlation to the end of the last glaciation applies to the accepted scientific models of the spread of agriculture. But does it? Or is it possible that important parts of the story of our past could have been veiled from us by the upheavals of the glacial cycle? Although I know that it was just the most recent of many glaciations, I use the term the last ice age to refer to the latest glacial expansion between 125,000 and 17,000 years ago. When I use the term last glacial maximum, LGM, I refer not to a specific moment, but to a period of approximately 5,000 years, between 22,000 years and 17,000 years ago, during which the ice sheets remained at or near their maximum extent. There was some melting and sea level rise after around 19,000 years ago, but the volume was relatively small and there was little impact on coastlines. What may truly be described as the epoch of the meltdown began immediately afterwards, say 16,500 years ago, with the massive ice sheet wasting and associated sea level rise complete by 7,000 years ago. Before the flood. Imagine the world before the flood. 17,000 years ago, at the end of the last glacial maximum, most of northern Europe and North America were buried under ice several kilometers thick. So much water was tied up in these continental ice caps that global sea level was between 115 and 120 meters lower than it is today. The antediluvian world, therefore, looked very different from the world we are familiar with. A land bridge joined Alaska and Siberia across what is now the Bering Strait. It was possible to walk from southern England to northern France across the dry valley that would later become the English Channel. Many more islands were exposed in the Mediterranean than are visible today, and existing islands were much larger. Malta, for example, was certainly joined onto Sicily. Corsica and Sardinia formed a single huge island. Further east, we have already seen that the whole of the Persian Gulf, as far as the Strait of Hormuz, was dry 17,000 years ago, but for its great alluvium-rich river and its life-giving lakes. Further east still, India's coastlines were much more extensive at the end of the last ice age than they are today, and the shape of the subcontinent was strikingly different. Sri Lanka was joined to the mainland, and south of Sri Lanka, sprawling across the equator, the Maldive Islands were far larger than they are today. Around modern Malaysia, Indonesia, and the Philippines, and stretching as far north as Japan, lay the endless plains of Sundaland, a fully-fledged antediluvian continent. It was submerged very rapidly sometime between 14,000 and 11,000 years ago. Up until about 12,000 years ago, the three main islands of Japan formed a continuous landmass. In the southern seas lay the gigantic Ice Age continent of Sahul, formed out of the united landmasses of Australia, Tasmania, and New Guinea. Across the Pacific, the thousands of small remote islands of today were integrated into much larger archipelagos 17,000 years ago. In the western Atlantic, in the same epoch, the Grand Bahama Banks, now shallowly submerged, formed a huge plateau 120 meters above sea level, and all of the Florida, Yucatan, and Nicaragua shelves were exposed. In short, the habitable landmasses that modern civilizations have inherited from the meltdown of the last ice age only began to take their present form in the 10 millennia between 17,000 and 7,000 years ago. Before that, areas that are densely populated today, Chicago, New York, Manchester, Amsterdam, Hamburg, Berlin, Moscow, in fact most of North America and Northern Europe, were absolutely uninhabitable due to the fact that they were covered by ice caps several kilometers thick. Conversely, many areas that are uninhabitable today, on account of being on the bottom of the sea or in the middle of hostile deserts such as the Sahara, which bloomed for about 4,000 years at the end of the last ice age, were once and relatively recently desirable places to live that were capable of supporting dense populations. Geologists calculate that nearly 5% of the Earth's surface, an area of around 25 million square kilometers or 10 million square miles, has been swallowed by rising sea levels since the end of the Ice Age. That is roughly equivalent to the combined areas of the United States, 9.6 million square kilometers, and the whole of South America, 17 million square kilometers. It is an area almost three times as large as Canada and much larger than China and Europe combined. What adds greatly to the significance of these lost lands of the last ice age is not only their enormous area, but also, because they were coastal and in predominantly warm latitudes, that they would have been among the very best lands available to humanity anywhere in the world at that time. Moreover, although they represent 5% of the Earth's surface today, it was worth reminding ourselves that humanity during the Ice Age was denied useful access to much of northern Europe and North America because of the ice sheets. So the 25 million square kilometers that were lost to the rising seas add up to a great deal more than 5% of the Earth's useful and habitable land space at that time. Now, imagine if you were to discover a hidden secret. The entire orthodox account of world prehistory, as it is presented in the classroom, at university, through books, and in the media, has been created by archaeologists with no reference whatsoever to China and Europe, or to South America and the landmass of the USA. Having missed out entirely such large areas from their excavations and research, wouldn't you feel that their conclusions about world prehistory and the story of the origins of civilization were likely to be, to say the least, flawed? Well, it is a similar story with the 25 million square kilometers lost at the end of the Ice Age. Marine archaeologists have barely even begun a systematic survey for possible submerged sites on these flooded lands. Most would regard it as a waste of time even to look. In consequence, whether in Australia or Europe, the Middle East, India, or Southeast Asia, the enormous implications of the changes in land use and rising sea levels between 17,000 and 7,000 years ago do not appear ever to have been seriously considered by historians and archaeologists seeking the origins of civilization. A case history: the drowned 3 million square kilometers of Sahul. Let's look more closely at what happened to Sahul, also known as Greater Australia, between approximately 17,000 and 7,000 years ago. Much of the story has been unraveled by the work of Jim Allen, an archaeologist at Australia's La Trobe University, and Peter Kershaw from the Department of Geography and Environmental Science at Monash University, Melbourne. Until the end of the last glacial maximum 17,000 years ago, and probably for several thousand years afterwards, New Guinea was fully integrated with the Australian continent across the Torres Strait and the Arafura Sea. Tasmania was fully integrated in the south, the Bass Strait then being dry land, and the other smaller now offshore islands were also incorporated. In total, Allen and Kershaw estimate that Sahul of 17,000 years ago extended from almost exactly the equator to nearly 44 degrees south, and from 112 degrees east to 154 degrees east. Then came the meltdown. Between circa 16,000 BP and 7,000 BP, Greater Australia was reduced in area by more than 3 million square kilometers, an area much larger than Mexico. Three major landmasses existed where previously there had been one. Coastal sites were either submerged or preserved on islands, while sites of the former arid interior became coastal. In places, the post-glacial marine transgression reduced the width of the coastal plain by up to several hundred kilometers, thus presumably drowning many terminal Pleistocene sites in the process. And how much else? There are, after all, a number of discontinuities and mysteries in the human story in Australia, not least the venerable antiquity of its first settlers, thought to date back as far as 50,000 years. Though there is no archaeological evidence whatsoever that a high civilization in the technical, material, or urban senses ever flourished here before the modern era, there are certain aspects of Aboriginal culture that are frankly puzzling and do not fit in. These include evidence of sophisticated astronomical ideas from a very early date, and the use of an astronomical terminology that is also found in other very distant regions of the world. Thanks to the research of the Russian prehistorian Boris Frolov, for example, we must now ask ourselves, Whether it is a coincidence that indigenous tribal peoples as far afield as North America, Siberia, and Australia all called the Pleiades star group the Seven Sisters. Frolov's own view is that coincidence is not a satisfactory explanation, and that only an extremely ancient shared heritage can account for this and many other thought-provoking parallels that he has uncovered. But if Frolov is right, as the Cambridge anthropologist Richard Rudgley observes in his groundbreaking Lost Civilizations of the Stone Age, then the implication is a tradition of communicable knowledge of the heavens that has existed for over 40,000 years, since a time roughly coinciding with the beginning of the Upper Paleolithic. This is something that is extremely awkward for most widely accepted views of the history of knowledge and science. In short, it is far, far too early for most people to accept. Of course, it is true that archaeologists excavating Australian terrestrial sites have not turned up any evidence there of the kind of social infrastructure that would normally be associated with the spread of a global astronomical tradition. But with more than 3 million square kilometres of Greater Australia submerged between 16,000 and 17,000 years ago, and almost entirely unexplored by archaeologists, who can be sure what yet might be found? Floods and civilization. Were the post-glacial floods really floods at all? It doesn't take a mathematical genius to work out that 120 meters of sea level rise spread out over 10,000 years amounts to an average of not much more than a meter a century. Inconvenient, certainly, but surely not enough to submerge and sweep away all traces of a great civilization. Surely not enough to inspire the global myth of the flood, so often accompanied, as it was in Sumer, by the unshakable conviction that the gods had resolved to obliterate mankind. In previous books, I've discussed the cycle of the Ice Ages. Over the past 2.6 million years, this cycle shows strong correlations with the slowly changing obliquity and precession of the Earth's axis and the varying degree of eccentricity of its orbit around the Sun. Some scientists feel that these large-scale astronomical influences are sufficient on their own to explain the recurrent glaciations and deglaciations of our planet. Others feel that trigger factors must also be involved. Extreme episodes of volcanism, asteroidal or cometary impacts, a realignment of the Earth's crust or mantle, and so on and so forth. Irrespective of the cause, however, there is no dispute about the biggest consequence of the meltdown of the last ice age. Sea level is now 120 meters higher than it was 17,000 years ago. This, by any standards, represents a dramatic change in the distribution of habitats for human settlement and should, one might expect, be a matter of great interest to archaeologists. When I began to research this subject, I was therefore surprised to learn that this is not at all the case. Only an infinitesimal amount of marine archaeology has been done along continental shelves, infinitesimal in relation to the total area of land submerged worldwide. Of the marine archaeology that has been done, the largest part has been focused upon the discovery and excavation of shipwrecks and of sites submerged in historical times. With the exception of Robert Ballard's exciting underwater survey of the Black Sea for the National Geographic Society, which got underway in 2000 and has been oriented directly towards an investigation of a colossal incursion of the Mediterranean through the Bosporus Narrows, 7,500 years ago, marine archaeology has simply not concerned itself with the possibility that the post-glacial floods might in any way be connected to the problem of the rise of civilizations. I'm aware that there is a new mood of political correctness amongst archaeologists and a willingness to accept and state publicly that the peoples of the Stone Age were neither ignorant savages nor lowbrow cavemen, although one need only spend a moment glancing at the transcendental art of Lascaux to realize that. But still, it seems to me true to say that the great majority of archaeologists see no particular trend or connection that obviously links the Paleolithic way of life, 17,000 or even 12,000 years ago, to the urban way of life that first appears at Jericho, Katalhayak, and a handful of other sites between 10,000 and 7,000 years ago. This is why, although they are certainly more open than they were before to the spirituality and high artistic culture of the ancients, archaeologists, almost without exception, do still assume that the population of the Earth was at a uniformly hunter-gatherer level of social and economic development 17,000 years ago, and still about 7,000 years away from founding the first cities. They therefore have no particular reason to be interested in the fact that millions of square kilometers of continental shelf were flooded in the intervening years, changing the face of the habitable Earth completely. If, on the other hand, the level of development of different cultures in that period was not uniform, as is the case in the world today, and if one or several cultures had concentrated along the ancient seashores or in any other areas which might have been rapidly and cataclysmically inundated, then it is possible that the post-glacial floods could have had enormous significance for the story of civilization. Moreover, the rise in sea level of 120 meters over those 10,000 years between 17,000 and 7,000 years ago is large enough to have engulfed entire cities forever and either demolished or covered up with millennial deposits of silt and muck, all evidence of their former existence. If the waves rose slowly, such hypothetical cities would have been pounded for centuries in the high-energy intertidal zone, which makes short work even of granite structures. But if the sea level rise was due to some cataclysmic surge, then walls of water would have borne down and crushed beyond recognition much that stood in their path. Many things happening at once. It is hard to know where to begin to tell the story of the meltdown of the last ice age, because it is really many different stories woven together into a single fabric. Part of it concerns large-scale climate flips, sudden radical thaws and equally radical freezes, volcanism on a planetary scale, earthquakes of unparalleled ferocity, and mass extinctions of animal species. Part of it, which I've already touched on, is the huge loss of habitable land, of low-lying coastal plains and fertile river deltas that occurred as the sea level rose, a lost continent scattered around the world like the pieces of a jigsaw puzzle with a combined land area of 25 million square kilometers. Part of it concerns the speed and the sheer magnitude of the post-glacial flooding. Part of it is the need to understand the processes that led the Earth into this devastating cycle of inundations. Part of it is a complexity. Yes, global sea level did rise by 120 meters between 17,000 and 7,000 years ago. No, this eustatic rise, that is, pertaining to sea level alone, has not been uniformly reflected in changing shorelines through time. Thus, in some parts of the world, sea level relative to ancient shorelines has remained quite stable for millennia. In yet others, submersion may be shallower than expected from eustatic changes. Such variations can be caused by local land subsidence or land rise following earthquakes or volcanic activity. However, a much more potent and extensive agent of changing land levels is known to geologists as isostasy. Kicking the gel-filled football. The Earth's surface, which seems solid beneath our feet, can yield and deform when subjected to sufficiently large pressures. It behaves a bit like a football that has been loosely filled with a thick, heavy gel. Pressure at one point on the gel-filled ball will result in an indentation in that area, a displacement of the fluid mass within, and a corresponding rise in a roughly circular area surrounding the indentation. Geologists call this process isostasy, and it plays an important role not only during ice ages, but also for thousands of years after all the ice has melted away. The reason it does so is that the vast weight of the ice caps is sufficient to force down the Earth's crust into great basin-like depressions beneath them. When the ice melts, that pressure is suddenly removed, and the floors of the basins begin to rebound. They will, if sufficient time is allowed, rise again to their original levels. At the LGM 17,000 years ago, the ice caps over large parts of North America and Northern Europe were between 2 and 4 kilometers thick. and applied loads of thousands of billions of tons to the continental land masses on which they had formed. Thomas Crowley and Gerald North, both oceanographers at Texas A&M University, observed that North America's Laurentide ice sheet extended from the Rocky Mountains to the Atlantic shore and from the Arctic Ocean southward to about the present positions of the Missouri and Ohio rivers. In Europe, the Fennoscandian ice sheet reached northern Germany and the Netherlands. The weight of the massive ice sheets depressed the crust by as much as 700 to 800 meters, resulting in gravity anomalies that are still detectable. On average, it has been found that 100 meters of ice loading depresses continental crust by 27 meters. But this is only part of the story. The water of the world's oceans also has weight. Indeed, it is denser than ice. Thus, 100 meters of water loading depresses the seabed beneath it by 30 meters. Since all the ice formed on land during the last ice age was made out of water extracted from the sea, it follows that while the crust was pressed down beneath the continents, it actually rose up beneath the oceans as the water burden above it lightened. Conversely, after all the ice had melted and returned to the oceans as water, the burden on the seabed would have again increased. R.C.L. Wilson, professor of earth sciences at Britain's Open University, calculates that a layer of water 165 meters deep was subtracted from the oceans to make the great ice caps of the last glaciation. This, however, only produced a net drop in relative sea level of around 115 meters between the onset of glaciation 125,000 years ago and the onset of LGM 104,000 years later. The reason for the discrepancy being that reduced water loading in the oceans during the Ice Age allowed the seabed to rise by 50 meters through the process of isostatic compensation. Let's stop for a moment and take another look at the seesaw system swing by swing. 1. 125,000 years ago, the most recent glacial surge begins, turning a worldwide layer of ocean 165 meters deep into ice caps thousands of meters high, piled up for the most part in North America, Greenland, Northern Europe, South America, and the Himalayas. 2. The maximum extent of ice formation is reached 21,000 years ago and largely maintained until 17,000 years ago. By this time, the continental crust beneath the big ice caps had been depressed into huge basins nearly a kilometer deep. 3. Simultaneously, as the ice burden on the land increases, the water burden on the seabed decreases. By the last glacial maximum, this had allowed the ocean floor around the world to rise by 50 meters. 4. Soon after the LGM, the ice begins to melt and to flow back as water to the oceans, a process that is substantially over within 10,000 years. 5. Since a layer of water 165 meters deep was taken out of the oceans to begin with to make up the ice caps, it follows that a layer of water 165 meters deep is returned to the oceans with a complete melting of the ice sheets. 6. Professor Wilson observes that the rate at which the crust and mantle respond to loading and unloading is much slower than the buildup or melting of ice caps. This is why areas that were buried beneath several kilometers of ice 18,000 years ago are still rising today, thousands of years after the ice sheet melted away. 7. It also follows that the average 50-meter rebound of the ocean floor between 125,000 and 17,000 years ago would take thousands of years to be forced down again by isostatic subsidence to its original level. 8. Measured at a warm point in a long interglacial and after 17,000 years of isostatic subsidence, today's sea level is probably quite close to the final balance in the equation of rising seas and sinking seabeds. But there must have been many times during the meltdown of the Ice Age when the speed of the former far outstripped any compensating effects of the latter. Is it not possible, perhaps even probable, that this combination of a higher seafloor than today's and rapid influxes of meltwater from the decaying ice caps could have produced relative temporary rises in sea level much greater than the average annual rate projected over the full period of the meltdown? Seesaw. Examples of segments of continental crust that continue to rise through isostatic rebound since the removal of the ice sheets include the highlands of Scotland, where the ice cap that once covered most of Britain was at its thickest. The floor of the Gulf of Bothnia, in what is now the Baltic Sea, reported to be rising at a rate of a meter per century. Large parts of the coast and mainland of Sweden, Denmark, and Norway, the northeast coast of Canada, and parts of southern Chile. Complicating the picture is the fact that around each zone of post-glacial rebound, there lies what geologists call a peripheral zone of submergence, which is always larger than the zone of rebound. Thus, while it is not uncommon to find such phenomena as raised beaches in the highlands of Scotland, demonstrating graphically that areas that were once at sea level and formed an ancient coastline have now been lifted well above it, other areas of the British Isles are visibly sinking into the sea. This is because the downward pressure of the Fennoscandian ice sheet on the northern European continental crust at the LGM was transformed by the mechanism of isostatic compensation into a huge forebulge several hundred kilometers beyond the ice margin, literally as though one end of a seesaw had been forced down, pushing the other end up. As the ice melted, the weight that was holding the end of the seesaw down was released, allowing it to rise again and causing the other end, the forebulge, to fall. This is exactly what is happening in the English Channel today, which we've heard was entirely dry at the LGM. The Isle of Wight stood on the forebulge of the Fennoscandian ice sheet forced upwards by isostatic compensation. Then, when the ice sheet melted, the dynamics of isostasy again came into play, and the forebulge began to subside, taking the Isle of Wight and much of southern England down with it. Isostatic Atlantis. An ingenious theory of the lost land of Atlantis, the first that I am aware of, that is explicitly based on the relationship between isostasy and rising sea levels, was put forward in the late 1990s by Vyacheslav Kudryavtsev, a member of the Russian Geographical Society of the Russian Academy of Sciences. It is well known that the story of Atlantis was set in writing in the 4th century BC by the Greek philosopher Plato in his dialogues Critias and Timaeus. But before that, Plato tells us it had been an oral tradition passed down within his family from his ancestor Solon, the revered Athenian lawmaker. Solon had been told it during a visit that he made to Egypt at around 600 BC. His informant, in turn, had been an elderly Egyptian priest at the Temple of Sais in the Delta, who said that he had drawn the information from written records, then more than 8,000 years old, lodged in the temple's archives. There are four essential ingredients in Plato's story. Atlantis was a relatively advanced, well-organized, and prosperous civilization. It flourished and was destroyed 9,000 years before Solon's time, in other words, approximately 11,600 years before our time. It was located on a large island opposite the Pillars of Hercules, presumed to be the modern Straits of Gibraltar. Its destruction was the result of a global cataclysm. There were earthquakes and floods of extraordinary violence, and in a single dreadful day and night, the island of Atlantis was swallowed up by the sea and vanished. There have been 1,000 theories about the location of lost Atlantis, moving it around in time according to individual researchers' whims, and placing it everywhere from the mid-Atlantic ridge to Indonesia, and from the Andes Mountains to Crete. What Kudryavtsev is suggesting is just another theory. Nevertheless, it has the great merit of requiring no liberties to be taken with Plato's text, either in respect of the location of Atlantis, beyond the Straits of Gibraltar in the Atlantic Ocean, or of the date of its submergence, 11,600 years ago. Kudryavtsev's location is an area known to fishermen as the Little Sole Bank, situated on a vast underwater plateau called the Celtic Shelf, 200 kilometers to the southwest of the British Isles and Ireland. Although the shallowest part of Little Sole Bank is now 57 meters beneath the waves, and thus might be expected to have been about 60 meters above sea level just before the end of the last ice age, Kudryavtsev's research shows that it and a large area of the surrounding shelf may have been tilted dramatically upwards during the last build-up to the last glacial maximum by the seesaw effect of isostatic forces emanating from the continental ice mass. In brief, his theory is that there is an unusually rapid collapse of the forebulge in this area around 11,600 years ago, coinciding with a ferocious episode of ice melting and global flooding, the sudden inundation of Atlantis described by Plato. In my opinion, states Kudryavtsev, the most serious argument in favor of the assumption that Atlantis was not invented by Plato is that the time when it vanished, as indicated by Plato, about 11,600 years ago, and the circumstances of its vanishing described by him, the sinking into the deep of the sea, coincide with the findings of modern science about the end of the last ice age and the substantial rise of the level of the world ocean that accompanied it. Three global superfloods. Anyone who has read the Timaeus and Critias carefully knows that what Plato describes in his account of the destruction of Atlantis is indeed a global flood that took place approximately 11,600 years ago and that swallowed up huge land masses as far apart as the Eastern Mediterranean and the Atlantic Ocean. I would have thought that a first line of approach for scholars investigating Plato's claims would be to find out whether anything on this scale might actually have happened in the world 11,600 years ago. So far as I can discover, however, not a single historian or prehistorian has ever made the effort to do so, although many of them have put forward theories, usually widely applauded by their peers, locating Atlantis anywhere but in the Atlantic, where Plato says it was, and any time within the epoch of recorded history, rather than considering the prehistoric date of 9600 BC given by Plato. One of the ludicrous but positively peer-reviewed claims put forward to divert the debate endlessly into trivia is that Plato meant 9,000 months before Solon's time, not 9,000 years, when he spoke of the submergence of Atlantis. In my experience, historians and archaeologists will go through Houdini-like contortions of reason and common sense rather than consider the possibility that their paradigm of prehistory might be wrong. So I'm not surprised that they have never attempted to investigate at face value the Atlantis tradition of a devastating global flood 11,600 years ago. However, there are scholars trained in other disciplines and not hobbled by the same preconceptions who are more open to the possibility that the flood tradition in general and the Atlantis story specifically might be rooted in the real events of the meltdown of the last ice age. This view has been entertained positively by the late Cesar Emiliani, for example, former professor in the Department of Geological Sciences at the University of Miami, one of the pioneers of the isotopic analysis of deep-sea sediments as a way to study the Earth's past climates. Moreover, Emiliani's fieldwork in the Gulf of Mexico has produced striking evidence of cataclysmic global flooding between 12,000 and 11,000 years ago. Robert Schock, professor in the Department of Geology at Boston University, observes that there was also a dramatic warming of the Earth's climate in the same period, the pre-boreal, and that overall there is a stunning lineup in time between the sudden warming of 9645 BC, Emiliani's scenario of a massive freshwater flood pouring into the Gulf of Mexico, and the date Plato ascribed to the sinking of Atlantis. Whatever the accuracy of specific details, this curious coincidence points to the effect sudden climatic changes can have, and no doubt have had, on civilization. Science writer Paul LaViolette likewise argues that there may be much truth to the many flood cataclysm stories that have been handed down to modern times in virtually every culture of the world. In particular, the 9600 BC date that Plato's Timaeus gives for the time of the deluge happens to fall at the beginning of the pre-boreal at the time of the upsurge of meltwater discharge. Before rejecting the possibility of a lost civilization of the last ice age, therefore, I urge historians and archaeologists to take a close look at the mass of data that now exists about the sequence of cataclysmic floods that swept the Earth between 17,000 and 7,000 years ago. Yet this, too, is a contentious area of debate. For while scientists now agree on the approximate figure of 120 meters for sea level rise during the 10,000 years of post-glacial flooding, many do not accept that these were floods at all, and certainly not in the cataclysmic sense. Averaging the rise over the time span as we did earlier, they see a fairly gradual and distinctly non-cataclysmic process in the range of a meter a century. This remains the majority view. But since Emiliani's findings first began to undermine it in the 1970s, there's been more and more research to show how very cataclysmic the meltdown of the Ice Age could in fact have been. In brief, what is being suggested is that during the long span of the meltdown, in addition to countless episodes of smaller scale flooding, there were three global superfloods which have been dated within the following approximate time bands: 15,000 to 14,000 years ago, 12,000 to 11,000 years ago, and 8,000 to 7,000 years ago. I found that estimates of these dates vary by more than 1,000 years either way, depending upon which authority you consult, but the general point is clear enough. There now exists a strong case that nearly half the total meltwater release at the end of the last ice age was concentrated into these three relatively short episodes, creating conditions of concentrated damage after long periods of stability, precisely the combination of circumstances and bad luck that could have led ultimately to the destruction of an antediluvian culture. Professor Emiliani's ice dams. Cesare Emiliani made many original contributions to scientific understanding of the meltdown of the last ice age. He was also the first to work out the precise mechanism behind the characteristic rhythm of this 10,000-year period, millennia of slow melting and gradual sea level rises interrupted, apparently randomly, by much shorter episodes of extremely severe global flooding and rapid destructive oceanic transgressions. During the last ice age, ice reached its maximum extension 20,000 years ago. Deglaciation started almost immediately and progressed rapidly. Sometimes ice meltwater would pile up behind an ice dam, and when the dam collapsed, a huge flow would follow. One such great flood occurred in the American Northwest 13,500 years ago, when an ice dam holding back about 2,000 cubic kilometers of ice meltwater, Lake Missoula, collapsed. A huge mass of muddy water and debris rushed across the area into the Columbia River, cutting broad channels called coulees and forming the so-called channeled scabland. As a result of the flood that formed the scabland, the sea level rose very rapidly, from minus 100 to minus 80 meters, vis-à-vis today's level. By 12,000 years ago, more than 50% of the ice had returned to the ocean and the sea level had risen to minus 60 meters. At that point, other giant floods occurred, down the Mississippi River Valley into the Gulf of Mexico and down the Siberian River valleys into the Arctic Ocean. The Mississippi flood carried pebbles, which are now confined to the upper reaches of the Missouri-Mississippi system, all the way down to the Delta. Sea level rose very rapidly from minus 60 meters to minus 40 meters. The key phrase that caught my attention when I first read this passage was ice dam. It was very simple, and yet it explained so much. Averaged out over 10,000 years, it was true that the total global sea level rise of 120 meters at the end of the last ice age only amounted to a little more than a meter a century. But what Emiliani is now suggesting was the intriguing possibility that enormous quantities of glacial meltwater could have been detained for thousands of years behind ice dams on continental Europe and continental North America, and then released into the open ocean all at once. The ice caps that formerly covered these areas were up to 4 kilometers thick, as we've heard, and larger than present-day Antarctica in both cases. Emiliani reminds us how the weight of the ice on the land surface below created bowl-shaped depressions about 1 kilometer deep. Heat from the interior of the Earth was trapped under the ice sheets, the bottom ice melted, and great freshwater lakes formed. Twice in North America and western Siberia, these lakes busted through the ice margins and created huge floods. Sea level rose abruptly around 13,000 years ago, and again 11,000 years ago, and then more slowly as the residual ice continued melting. Some have hypothesized that these prehistoric floods generated the flood legends common to many civilizations. Professor Shaw's abrupt steps. John Shaw, professor of earth sciences at the University of Alberta, is one of the world's leading experts on the last ice age and on its catastrophic meltdown. The author of an impressive list of peer-reviewed scientific papers, his research is at the forefront of inquiry in this field and has focused on the reasons for the superfloods. This is the graphic account that he gave us. The big ice sheets that covered Canada, most of Scandinavia, and much of northern Russia, instead of them being pure ice and rock, it seems that at a late stage there was rock at the bottom and then a subglacial lake or reservoir of water, then the ice. And it's possible that when warming occurred, the top of the ice started to melt and the ablation zone and the subglacial water got bigger and bigger and bigger. And yet, for good reason, the ice sheet seals around the edges. And then one time, the big system on top connects. It's a little bit like a toilet bowl. You sort of open the valve and the water comes surging through. In Canada, on one occasion, the water literally came spewing out all over, except to the east of the Hudson Strait, because there was a big ice barrier there. So it came out southwards and through the St. Lawrence, through the Finger Lakes, down through the Red River, South Winnipeg and the Winnipeg Lakes, and out through parts of Saskatchewan and out over the Milk River, which is the continental divide south of Alberta. The Milk River water flowed north to the Arctic, to the east of the Hudson Bay, south to the Gulf of Mexico. And a huge amount of water went north into the Arctic Ocean. So you were suddenly introducing a vast amount of water to the oceans. And the duration of the flows was probably measured in weeks. And the kind of flow that we're talking about, just for a small filament in Alberta, would have been 10 million cubic meters per second that would drain Lake Ontario in about 4 days. And sea level would have risen instantly and somewhere in the region of 10 meters. This is about 15,000 years ago, when there were people living in many places. And the sea level would have suddenly risen, and if you had lived by the seashore collecting jellyfish or something like that, and your house was suddenly underwater, you'd notice it. I imagine that it had quite an impression on the oral tradition and myths. So the big event came from under the ice about 15,000 years ago. And then about 11,000 years ago, there was a big lake in the southern part of the ice sheet called Lake Agassiz that covered a big part of Canada. There was an equally big lake called the Baltic Ice Lake in Scandinavia. And then recent evidence suggests that there were big lakes across northern Asia and the north of the Soviet Union. These lakes were dammed by ice and tended to drain very suddenly. And as a result, you get a similar effect, with a sudden rise in sea level. And then last of all, about 8,000 years ago, there was the last lake in North America associated with the Laurentide ice sheet, which is called Lake Ojibwe, and it lay just south of the Hudson Strait. And that lake drained catastrophically. So originally it was thought that the rise of sea level was steady at the end of the ice age, but now we're able to see that it rose abruptly in steps. Floods, volcanoes, earthquakes. Professor Shaw's abrupt steps were arguably the most traumatic experiences of global cataclysm that our species has ever undergone. To those alive then, the end of the last ice age, with its sudden global floods, must have seemed like the end of the world. Continental plates were shifting upwards, relieved of the weight of the ice they'd supported for 100,000 years. Huge earthquakes and outbreaks of volcanism accompanied this extensive crustal rebalancing. The earth would have rung like a bell, with tremendous sounds and vibrations. The sky would have been heavy with volcanic dust and black bituminous rain. And at the same time, the oceans were remorselessly, apparently unstoppably rising. One of the geoclimatological mysteries of the last ice age is that the period of the meltdown, roughly from 17,000 to 7,000 years ago, was also a period of dramatically enhanced volcanic activity. A paper published in Nature in October 1997 draws particular attention.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.